Hey. All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Warpaint Championship Finals, the Grand Finals, of course. I'm Stormless. I'm here with Generals Gentleman, who, yes, chat, is also in Canada.
I'm definitely in Canada.
We've got Jezelin here and DevM today. Hello, guys.
Hi.
Hello, guys.
These are your heroes for the day. We're just going to have a little quick chat before the games start, and then obviously we're going to go into game one of the tournament. Thanks everyone that's joined straight away as well. It's a pleasure to have already 300 people on the stream. So yeah, how are you feeling today, guys? You ready for this?
Feeling a bit nervous, I guess. But yeah, I'm fine mostly.
I'm okay. I am prepared to play.
Ooh. This is good. This is switched from yesterday, you know? It's actually, DevM's now got the nerves. Did something happen last night? Did you have a square up at the hotel? Perhaps. No? Okay, so, one second. What is the,
Hope you would like the background as well. We spent a fair bit of time balancing Company of Heroes 2.
Yep.
Company of Heroes 2 is now balanced, thanks to our efforts. And you can't really see it as well, but there's like,
We'll clear it out in a bit.
There's a couple of grenades down there. Stormless and I, we held the rifles together, and we were a blob of rifles. It was amazing. It was a dream come true.
It was good. So we've got just a couple of quick things that we want to do before the game start. Obviously, just to keep things in good humor. The first one is we found this item in Relic Studios that we thought looked very suspicious.
As the
pinwheel. So, in fact, let's bring that in quickly.
Yeah.
We've got a quick little thing we're going to do. So this is the wheel of RNG. We found this at one of the developer desks, and we've kind of customized it a little bit. So here we go. This is the wheel of RNG, and what we've got on it is different types of RNG. It could be squad water mipes, Panzerfausts vanishing into thin air. It could be a number of things. And basically, the players are going to spin it today. This is going to be their vulnerability RNG for the day. We'll see if it actually bears any significance in the game. So, Jezelin, what's your feared RNG, and then spin the wheel.
I know, squad wipe.
Yeah.
You already know. With American Sherman.
Yeah. Well, that's actually one of them. Is the tank wipe, I believe. So, spin the wheel, Jezelin.
Okay.
See what you have in store for today. What do we have?
Ooh, it's tense already.
It's gonna be. You're gonna lose all your squads to being one shot by a Sherman, Jezelin. It's gonna happen.
Tank one shot squad is the.
Actually, we should probably take that off and put it on camera if you want.
There we go. That's the RNG for Jezelin at the moment. Okay, let's go. Do you want to put that back on just
in
case,
sure.
Devem also. Has this okay? So what's your feared?
I guess the abandoned vehicle.
Oh, abandoned vehicle! I hope we get to see this actually. So
I know you love abandoned Stormless.
It's going to happen.
All right, here we go.
The RNG. Man, this is so good.
This is
not
like,
rigged. We promise.
This
the raffles
exactly
are rigged, but not this.
This is exactly why people are suspicious. So, yep, there we go.
Man, that's amazing. We're up to a fantastic start, aren't we, Stormless?
So, tanks are going to play a significant role in today's games. We
don't
think,
build tanks, Devin. Just don't even do it.
So, does that make you feel any better about today's games? Or?
No, it doesn't.
No. Fantastic. Okay, well, maybe we'll spin that in a couple of games as well. So yeah, of course, we're not going to keep these guys too long. This is just a little bit of chat, of course. We will have a little bit of a between games interview in a couple of games' time. Other than that, guys, feel free to shake hands, go and take your places in the game room, and best of luck to both of you.
Good luck and fun. That was amazing.
That is brilliant. I'm so glad we found that. I think that's
Stormless has spent the past hour and a half like frantically trying to get the stream all set up, and meanwhile I've just been preparing this stupid
just
RNG.
Been preparing the wheel
for the RNG
wheel of RNG. Yeah.
It's just a shame we didn't have Blake here, because he's like Japanese like TV presenter impression is fantastic, so he would have really got into it. He would have been like, "Duh, abandon tanku." It would have been like really funny, but yeah, we'll have to manage.
Yeah, so it's good, and hopefully as well. We've changed a lot of stuff in the Relic setup, actually. So this is, of course, the room where we see Carl streaming from, and we've got this noisy fan up here, and hopefully it's sounding a lot better for you guys. In fact, we're gonna get the game opened up as well, so that we're ready to go into this. These are gonna be great games today. As I say, both players have been pretty responsible for today's games. Jezza, they both had pretty early nights.
Yeah, we were drinking Stormless and I. We went pretty hard, didn't we?
We went full whack. Yeah.
But, DevM had one. We managed to peer pressure him into having one. And yep. Jezlin was just like, no, I must go back to gym. And he actually went to the gym, I believe, in his hotel.
Yeah, I think he did. Got an early night. So he's prepared for it in the right way, which is good. I'd love to show you guys what the setup is for them in there, because it's set up a bit like a StarCraft. It's a bit like that, they've got the camo netting.
Oh yeah,
they've
it's
got
so
camo
cool.
netting between them, so they can just about see through the camo netting.
I have a photo of it. I don't know how well they'll go up on stream.
Oh, okay.
It's a shame we didn't have an IP camera set up or anything.
That was
yeah.
Yeah,
do you
want to
show that? Maybe full screen on the phone.
Okay, that's
just double click it. I think it.
Yeah. Can you?
Oh, you have to
turn it rotation. I think that's the easiest way.
Yeah.
You'll be able to see what's been done for them. When GG sorts his phone out.
Technology, man.
Technology. What is this?
I don't even like technology that much.
Okay, so here is DevM and Jezlin. That's where they're playing at the moment, which is pretty cool. Got some props and some things, haven't we? There for them. So they're just doing the vetoes at the moment. A bit of an update.
Yeah, some pretty next level production quality. they are in a different room. They're a few doors down, so they definitely can't hear us. We have the doors closed off. They're in their own room, and we have Carl moderating as well in a different room. So it's all pretty legit.
It is. It's a nice setup, and of course, seeing Relic Studios has been absolutely fantastic as
yeah.
well. It's a lot bigger than I imagined it was going to be as well. So,
I've taken so many photos.
Yeah,
there's just so many funny, quirky things, whether it's all of the Warhammer 40,000 miniatures they have painted, or if it's the stupid whiteboards that have these funny messages on them. You can tell it's a really upbeat studio. It seems like it's a really cool atmosphere to be in. Of course, today it's a Saturday and it's the Thanksgiving weekend, so it's dead here. Kyle is literally the only person in the office today, apart from us, obviously. Whereas yesterday when we were in here, we had a tour of the studio. It was pretty packed and the people were working really hard. We were walking around and they were all working on Dawn of War 3, and we saw some NDA things that we obviously can't talk about as they're working on it from the desk. So it was actually really exciting.
Yeah, it's been an interesting weekend, of course.
Yeah.
But the main focus has been today. How are we feeling about predictions for today? So I mean, I think
3-1, to be honest. I think Jezlin will bring it back for one game.
I think so. Yeah. We discussed a lot yesterday. DevM, we know exactly what he's going to be playing. We know the factions he's going to be playing. We know the strategies he's going to be playing. It really does come down to Jezlin kind of being able to overcome it and just find a way around that. Jezlin looks like he's feeling really confident today. Do you know what I mean? He's coming with a really strong face on. Do you know what I mean? He's been very reserved a lot of the time, hasn't he?
Yeah.
And he's just looking really confident. And I know because they have been scrimming together.
Yeah.
He has beaten DevM on a couple of occasions. So there is that kind of background feeling there could be these kind of upsets, so we're really looking forward to that. As I say, DevM's weakness today will probably be that he is very predictable.
Absolutely.
So
yeah, DevM, he has very predictable play styles and build orders and strategies. It's more about the cheers. Hey, sorry, I just had to promote the cool stuff we have here. It's more about he's very aggressive. He's very sniper reliant. So I feel like DevM, if he loses that sniper initially, if maybe DevM gets a really nice flank off, then DevM could definitely crumble. Especially, also depends on the maps. I feel like the map vetoes are very important, because we talked about this a fair bit with Jezlin and DevM. Jezlin is a much more all-rounder player. He can play any faction. He can play any map. He has a bit wider breadth of experience in terms of different matchups. Where Devam, he only plays US and Wehrmacht. Yeah. He only plays those maps. And there are some maps where Wehrmacht aren't very strong. Colodny Femme, for example, it's very close quarters combat, a lot of shot blockers and ambush locations. So the sniper is much harder to use on that map. And because Wehrmacht and Devam's Wehrmacht in particular are very sniper oriented. Yeah. So I think map vetoes will be very important here for Jezelin. He really wants to try and secure Colodny. I believe Samoski is also on the map pool. I know it isn't a very popular map, but I feel like that could also be a good map for Jezelin, just because, again, it isn't very good for the sniper. You have a lot of buildings, a lot of shot blockers and ambush locations.
Yeah, that's good. I think where Devam will also be weakness is when he is playing the sniper, because we know that he will famously always rebuild that sniper it's gone. Like, Jezelin can close the early game sniper play down, then you're always going to roll Devam into the situation where he's spending loads.
Yeah.
Let's have a look what's going on. So yeah, just to keep you guys updated, the game hasn't started yet. So calm down. Anybody who OG HBL, you should kind of get how this works by now. We've been doing it long enough. So yeah, it's going to go in with game one very shortly. But right now we have a little bit of a chance to.
They're doing map vetoes currently.
Yeah, yeah. And the map vetoes as well, we spoke about Colodny Firma being a big one with the whole OKW situation.
Yeah.
Jezelin's favourite faction at the moment is the OKW. It's the one he feels most confident playing in the 1v1. So, but I think where he does stand that best chance to beat Devam is allies. I just think if he's playing allies and he does get the sniper and he keeps rolling Devam into spending 360 manpower, he has the best opportunity to just overwhelm everything that the Oster has. We'll see how that goes. But certainly not the same kind of high-intensity ego Devam as we saw yesterday. Devam really was giving it.
the favourite line that he said was, in the interview, do you have any words for your opponent? He was try to bring it out to more than three games.
Yeah.
Or something along that effect, which was, it was funny. It was nice little BM there, but in a friendly manner, of course. They're two very nice players here. We did get to meet them and have a pretty lengthy conversation with the two of them. During the day we had the tour, we played Dawn of War 3, and then last night we went into the town and got some drinks and such. So we're very excited to be here, and I feel for me personally, the fact that we have now met these two players and we have talked to them for so long, we've got a pretty good idea about who they are as two human beings. I feel it makes the stakes much higher, because now it's not just these two random people from the internet. It's these two players, these two people that we know. They have their own stories. They have their own ambitions. So it really does put the human side of it into esports, which I think is really nice. So I hope you guys watched the interview yesterday we did with them on the stream here, get a bit of an idea about who they are.
Yeah, they have really nice stories, actually. Of course, Jezelin is a student, so his money is just going into his education, which is really cool. It's being used for the best possible the best possible thing. It's been really interesting. I wonder how the vetoes are going right now. Every now and again, I just see Kyle running past the studio. Right? What's going on in there? Someone's rightly said, is there any risk putting Devam and Jezelin in the same room together?
I made the suggestion that we should give the helmet to Devam in case Jezelin loses and he gets really mad. then at least he has some kind of.
We should have got them up in all the correct kind of battle gear.
One thing that's really fascinating about Jezelin is, I don't know if you saw it when you're in the room, but he actually has a notebook, and he writes down all of the maps, and he has this very methodical veto process. I have a photo on my phone again, but it's he writes down what maps are good for what factions, and then he thinks about what his opponent's going to play, what his opponent's going to want. So he takes it very seriously. And it's quite charming because it's handwritten on a little notepad, so yeah. It's quite archaic, I suppose.
It's a weird, I don't really know anybody else that actually does that.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean? It's quite interesting, but it also shows how much he puts into the thought process of map selection.
There we go. What's up?
Fantastic. All right, so the game is now live. We're gonna go straight into that. We gotta load it first because I don't have an overlay specifically for loading.
That's not it. That's not it.
Yeah, that's fast.
You almost loaded into a 2v2 auto match on crossing
been,
in the woods.
That would have been impressive to do in the finals, yeah. To load into 2v2 on
crossing in the woods.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go. So it's Devim and Jezlin, so...
Really? I was not expecting them to be the players. Well, I am shocked.
I thought it made
what a turn of events.
It's US and OKW. That's what I was meant to say. It's OKW and US on Angoville. Whoa, this is not what I expected, actually. Angoville.
This is the decision for this is already kind of strikingly strange because Angoville is Devem's favorite.
Oh, absolutely.
Favorite map.
It's Ko-1 map that he's very fond of. It suits him so perfectly because it's very cut off heavy. It allows you to be so aggressive as really any faction, but especially US, where you have such a great follow up with the free squads, the powerful vehicles. It's Devem's jam. And as for Jezelin, it has the OKW. I would say that this map is much better for Wehrmacht, for mainly the fact that you don't have any reliable garrison clearing for OKW, you don't have any flamers. Your best thing is the incendiary grenades, obviously, but you don't get them that early on, so if you lose a cutoff within the first 5 minutes or so, that can be a bit rough getting that back, and it's very easy to dodge the incendiary grenades, especially, I'll just commandeer the camera here, especially if you're in this house, and then you grenade it, and then you go, okay, and you go in this house instead, and you just kind of keep ducking in and out of the different houses, and you can't just nade every single house because it's a lot of munitions down the drain. Whereas with a flamer, it's a one-off investment that then gives you a lot more use out of it. So yeah. It's not the best map for OKW, but we could definitely see Jezelin do well here. It's also a map that I would say has some good battle group locations. If he puts it behind these houses, you can have a nice little forward at HQ setup that's not too far away from the fuel point.
Yeah, the map itself is pretty good. I do think later on in the game, provided you get past that early. I just want to check one thing before I
feel a little powerless, actually, because whenever I cast, I always have camera control, and now Stormless is here, being all alpha male with the camera, and
sorry,
I'm just sitting back watching.
Sorry, we had this before, didn't we? The other thing I was going to say, though, is commander choices. I'm pretty sure Jezelin is going to play with the Scavenge Doctrine.
Oh, absolutely.
It's a great map to be popping out of those buildings. The other one, though, Mechanized Company, we heard in the interview yesterday that Devem really likes this commander, so I wonder if we're going to see that picked. But here we go, everybody. Welcome to game one of the finals of the Warpaint Championship. We are finally here, the climax of this insane event, and it's been crazy so far. Both Devem and Jezelin are in another room at the moment in Relic Studios, and of course they are facing each other literally.
Yep.
At this point. On the south side of Angerville, we have Devem playing as USF, and on the north side, Jezelin playing as the OKW.
Really exciting for us in particular. We are, of course, together in person in Vancouver, Canada, casting from the little studio here. So Stormless and I, in person, it's much better for us to cast. We have this good chemistry, and this is really exciting. You know, us. I float all the way from Australia, now in the other side of the world here in Canada. So it's been a really exciting weekend, and I'm really glad to see this game, the games in action, and see who triumphs. Who is the winner of the Warpaint Championship?
Well, here we're seeing that classic early game from Devem. Devem is always a person to watch in the early game. We know that this is his favorite map, and we know why. He loves to rush his early game units into the buildings, right deep into the opponent's territory. And what, of course, that allows him to do is start this process where he always goes for the frontline engagements. You know, he doesn't care about the VPs. He doesn't care about the resources. He just wants to keep Jezelin inside his base at all times and drag the game out. So that he can finish it early. And of course, this is a tactic that has worked for him over and over again, fantastically. So we're going to watch this early game very, very carefully. But I don't think we've actually seen that kind of huge aggression so far.
That house earlier is so crucial. If the Stern Pioneers actually made it into that house, it would have been really hard for DevM to clear through. US also not having access to flamers, so they can definitely struggle flushing out the houses. The Stern Pioneers you can kind of dislodge if you are behind far enough, but right now we see the Stern Pioneers getting a pretty low to these riflemen, taking a bit of damage in the negative cover. So DevM so far has been trading pretty well. The map control is not captured much for either player here. No one actually has their fuel point, no one has their munitions, so they're really prioritizing the key garrisons and trying to outmaneuver their opponents more than actually securing these resources.
Jezlin already getting a nice early push with the Kugel there, trying to push the echelons off. Stern Pioneers coming in close to the riflemen. There's a lot of engagements here that need to be managed correctly, and it looks like Jezlin hit the retreat button there on multiple things. Perhaps that was a little bit too heated. He doesn't want to lose early game to TevM. That would be an absolute disaster. So it's a sensible thing to do. He's going to make sure that he's got amicable map control. And just keeps the pressure on, really. I'll be interested to see whether he's going to tech up quickly and go for something like an MG, or whether he's going to invest in like another squad of infantry to try and match up with the USF.
So the territory, as I said, isn't really going to either player, but I would say this definitely favours Jezlin, because the longer that DevM doesn't have a fuel and doesn't have a lot of territory, it will delay his light vehicles, and light vehicles are very pivotal for the US. Able to do a lot of map pressure, force off squads, especially the Kubel wagon in particular. So Jezlin's aggressive play here is actually going to delay DevM's vehicles, which is really how he plays this matchup.
Really nice, the Kubel now has backed out of the engagements, capping around the edge of the map, trying to get OKW resources so that they can tech up. DevM again trying to be really cheeky here, go for that strategic cutoff to try and deny what the Kubel's been doing, but Jezlin is really on form here, yeah. Manages to push away that easily, leaving DevM with barely anything really. Look at the map right now. Really good early game from Jezlin.
Jezlin now has his fuel point connected to VP's. Only one of them is actually captured. We know that DevM isn't a play that prioritizes VPs. He's all about the fuel and the cutoffs. He wants to get the advantage and close it out. So I'm not too concerned about the VPs just yet. But yeah, DevM's definitely struggling here. Now we have the squad of Volks inside that house. So that's going to be really hard for DevM to flush out. He does have his lieutenant here. So perhaps he'll go for the M20. M20's nice at clearing out garrisons, can chase the Kubel down pretty effectively as well. We have Jezlin building his SWS truck, so he's not going to pull that behind the tech.
This is a nice one as well. We also saw here that Jezlin is preparing for the early game plays from DevM. He's already bought himself like a fairly good chunk of time with the early gameplay that we've seen. But now, you know, when things like maybe the M20 or, well, the M20 is actually in build at the moment, when that comes out, there is a chance that that will trigger the mine on the center road. If DevM does, like, you know, charge it up the map, there is a serious risk that that could happen there.
Yeah, I love how Jezlin is planting these mines. It's very important. And right now, Jezlin needs to know the timing of the light vehicles and keep his Kubel back. Get the Kubel capping very safe points. The worst thing you can do is overextend the Kubel as the M20 or whatever light vehicle it is arises, because it'll go down so fast the M20 can chase it down in particular. The M20, it has shown up now, so this is going to be a little bit harder for Jezlin. Let's see if he actually starts building a Raken. He has the resources for it.
This is a nice fight from Jezlin, though, trying to get the rifleman off of that strategic point. Here's the extension from the Kubel. Of course, the M20 is going to reveal itself against the infantry first. It's going to be interesting to see how Jezlin deals with this. Is he going to hit the retreat button? Volksgrenadier is losing a lot of health there.
Jezlin doesn't need to fight this here. There's no points connected. This is cut off, but there's only one point near it. So what Jezlin really needs to do is just try and hold the right side. Mine went off. Oh, only the rifleman, not the M20.
Yeah, that's a little bit of a sign there to DevM as well, that Jezlin has been planting these mines. Perhaps we'll see the Echelon squads now come up with minesweepers.
I like how there was the Volksgrenadier squad in the house near that cutoff. What that did is, it's not only is it going to hold the cutoff, but because it's so close to the mine, if the M20 actually hit the mine, Jezlin could get out of that, fire the Panzerfaust, and get that M20 very, very low. So we do have the battle group headquarters, has the medics completed now as well. Jezlin locking in the scavenge doctor, not a surprise for us. He's definitely said his absolute love for that commander. And the fact that he has the infiltration grenades, it will allow him to flush out the buildings very quickly. The Kubel could go down here to the 50 cal. Look at the Kubel. Yeah, it only takes one burst from it, though. I think Decal does take it out very quickly.
Again, this is a house that Jezlid really doesn't want to lose, but this is nice that Devon's managed to take it. And how he's doing that, of course, pushing up the left-hand side, making sure the focus is there, and then using, you know, his light vehicles to just go and clear the buildings out. So it's a lovely tactic from Devon. It's a great way to get the map control back. He kind of baited Jezlid onto coming over to the left side, whereas I don't really feel he needs to do that. When you're Axis, you can stay on the right-hand side, you get your resources, you get two VPs, and you also get a lot of choke points that you can hold. So actually going on the left side here, I think maybe a little bit of an early mistake sign for Jezlin. And here comes the Raketen. I think that cloaked a little bit late. I wonder if Devon maybe saw that with the M20.
The M20 has a lot of sight range, so you can see those things coming a bit earlier than you'd expect when you compare it to the sight range of just infantry, for example. Rifleman not getting in time to get the neutralize, or to prevent the neutralize on the VP. So Jezlin is still putting the pressure on. We have a squad of Jaegers spawning from the house. It's a very, very strong squad now. Riflemen on their own can't exactly deal with them unless they get a nice flank up close.
Yeah. That's a brilliant recovery because, of course, actually now Jezlin's done the exact same thing that DevM did. He baited DevM over to the left-hand side of the map with the M20, and then he managed to spawn the Jaeger infantry inside the building, meaning that he's now got control of the right-hand side again. He gets another chance at defending this area. And the M20 is going to have to be very, very careful with that Raketen on the front lines.
Nice reface there by DevM. He actually... the heavy cover prevented the suppression, so Jezlin actually does force the retreat there. Now it's going to be a dead Kubel. Maybe... Where's the Raketen, actually? I think it's not quite close enough. Vox moving in for the Faust here. The Kubel is trying to juke out, and actually he may keep it alive. Yeah, nice. Almost hitting the Faust.
Yeah, M20 will get out of that one. I think DevM knows that there's something around there. Probably the actual movement of the Kubel was a little bit of an indicator that something was happening there. And this is nice as well. Justin's going to be repairing this whilst capping the strategic point.
The Kubel should definitely cap the munitions put on the right side just because it's very safe. You want to cap the safe points. Capping the fuel, for example, there is a little bit dangerous, but it is the most important point right now. Jezlin has a lot of munitions and doesn't actually have any STG upgrades, so I wonder why that is. It's always worth getting the STGs.
I think we've seen this before, actually. I think we've seen players who kind of don't spend up on the STGs, but normally they all come out at once. It's like a large group upgrade. I'm interested to see, though, what the teching is going to be like. Is he going to go for another one of the trucks and maybe go up to the mechanized regiment? Or is he going to go for, the tier 4? The interesting thing is that I don't really feel like DevM is getting the USF kind of rollover, the snowball effect. I don't really feel like that's happened so far. Jezlin has kind of mitigated all of those signs of that happening in the early game. I think DevM is actually, although he's getting stronger, and we're starting to see great flanks now getting in some pretty important buildings on that side of the map. It's
our resource sector has been cut off from our supply chain.
The M20, it hasn't got any work done. That's really it, Stormless. Is the M20 hasn't forced any squads away, it hasn't got any wipes or anything, it hasn't done too much. And the fact that DevM was delayed so much, it meant that he couldn't go for the follow-up AA half-track, which is what he loves to do normally. I believe he has the captain now, so he actually teched for the tier 3. So I wonder why that was. Maybe he wants to get a steward out. Steward is a bit easier to keep alive than the AA half-track, has a bit more utility as well. The Raketen's actually forced away here, so now the M20 can be a bit more aggressive without having to be worried about getting hit by that Raketen. Vox moving up here for the Panzerfaust. Of course, the Jaegers don't have any Panzerfaust, so the M20 can go up as close as it wants to them without having to be afraid of the Panzerfaust. But actually, right now, the Panzerfaust will come through here.
Oh, no, it might hit the building, though. No, actually, it doesn't. Okay, so the Faust is off. It's going to be very easy for DevM to deal with that. Probably just going to kick the M20 off the front lines. And again, this building is so...
Oh, what? The rifle squad went down.
Oh, wow.
Oh, DevM.
Yeah, look, DevM's building it straight away. So actually, Jezlin's already getting these crazy, these crazy points where he's forcing DevM to rebuild units. This is something DevM famously does, which I think at least is a weakness in a sense, because he isn't going to, like, lose out on that unit. You know, he's going to need it on the field. So every wipe is a kind of double... That's a double benefit, because you know DevM is going to rebuild that unit. It's a core part of what his strategy is. A great wipe there.
The rifles dropped so quick, though. It was because there was like a lucky Volk shot that got a model down, but also then the scavenge squad, the Jaegers, they got the sniper crit as well. So the rifle went down very, very low, but you do always have to focus, to factor that in when you have a squad so low nearby the Jaegers, which can't get those crits very quickly. I wonder if it would have been worth DevM actually replacing his squad of rifles with a squad of rangers from the heavy cavalry commander rather than building rifles, because then they have a bit more firepower against the Jaegers in particular. The rangers are very powerful up close, which is where the scavengers aren't. This MG could go down here. The M20 on retreat can do a fair bit of damage against, especially with the rifle squads there as well. This could be a stolen MG.
Oh, that's a tough one. And also look at this, tier 4 going up in the base. The rifleman may spot it. The MG's captured as well, which could be a huge thing if DevM can turn that around and get that working on this. If he doesn't actually decide to do that, he's going to run away with the weapon. Infiltration nades coming down on the rifleman here, nearly actually taking the AI infantry down. This is a difficult engagement.
Let's see if the rifles go down here. The suppression comes through on one of the squads, maybe both of them as well. Oh, the rifles, they do escape this one. Nade as well from the Volks Grenadiers. So holding the ground is Jezelin. I feel like DevM could have actually just bursted down that Panzer headquarters. He had the M20, he had the MG34. Those trucks, when they're setting up, they do get taken out insanely fast, and I feel like that would have been pretty much a GG. If you lose 135 fuel on that Panzer headquarters, you can't really recover from that, especially against US. DevM going for his Stuart now, so he will have a very powerful light vehicle. A lot of munitions floated up as well here, so going for weapon racks would definitely be nice to see bars.
Not sure how I feel about this. The push to tier 4 from Jezelin, I mean, he now doesn't really have what he needs to defend the territories he's gained on the right-hand side. I think without having something like mechanized or even going, maybe he's going for the Oscarin still, you know, which is definitely a possibility. We've seen that before. But again, you know, if that's the case, why would you build tier 4 there that early?
Yeah, that's true. Maybe he wants overs, or maybe he just wants to have some kind of scaling. Maybe he'll get a Jagdpanzer out after his Ostwind. And also, you get a bit of command points when you deploy it. And when you have the resources, it's nice to have that set up. But just going multiple Ostwinds is definitely very effective, especially if you have multiple Rekens to support that as well. This M20 is going to be circling the Rekens. It shoots nearby as well here. This retreat path could be pretty antsy, especially with two squads of rifles there as well.
I'm pretty sure they'll make it back. And of course, the tier 4 is actually protecting Jezelin really from those light vehicles. You know, you know that there's not going to be any base rushes with that there, as well as the flak cannon. So I guess at least it's offering a little bit of protection from this light vehicle play, allowing him. And actually, look what it's covering.
Yeah.
You can see that it's covering the strategic points. I mean, that's probably the main thing for this. He's identified that DevM is consistently going for this point, and this is how he's going to try and stop that from happening. But that actually validates that decision. I actually think he's going to be going for the Ostwinds. I'm pretty sure of that. We're about to come up to an Ostwind unlock now, and maybe we can start to see things change around a little. If we could just get a snare maybe on one of the vehicles, then the Ostwinds will have a great opportunity. There's no real AT on the field from DevM, I think, at the moment. Maybe just the captain. Haven't really seen anything else so far.
DevM's putting a mortar. That's really strange. But there's no MG left. I wonder why he wants the mortar, because it's a pretty aggressive game. Jezelin isn't really holding any of these garrisons, so it's not like he needs to have the indirect fire, but I suppose it's just a really nice unit to have. It always can give you the edge in a battle if you have your mortar shelling off as well. So we do have the Ostwind. It has arrived. It's going to be able to duel with the Stuart, and especially the M20, as well as force away the Rifleman. So now I really wonder what the second tank will be. I think it'll ideally be a Panther if Jezelin can hold a fuel point for long enough, but maybe if he's desperate, he'll go for a Jagdpanzer 4. But DevM locking in the armor company, so we can expect to see the M10s, which is actually a really nice counter to the Ostwind. It comes out at a pretty similar time.
That's an interesting choice. I didn't really think that armor was going to be one of the picks here, if I'm totally honest. I was expecting... You know, it wasn't going to be mechanized, really, because that's really something you have to utilize at the start of the game. So I think, you know, we'd have known straight away. But really, with the Pershing there, with heavy cavalry, I wonder what he feels that lacks.
Devin loves Armor Company. Whenever I see him play US, he generally goes Armor Company. And again, it is a great counter to the Osvind, especially if you go the Bulldozer Shermans. In the late game, you can wipe squads with them very effectively. Even Rakettans get wiped very quickly. So I expect to see multiple M10s, 2, 3, maybe even 4 Osvinds. And then you also have access to the Railway, which is an insanely powerful artillery, or rather the 240 mil of the Railway. And he has the munitions floated up for it. I feel like definitely bars would be benefiting him right now, but having that 240 mil can be insanely powerful on the battle group. The MV's getting pretty low here. A lot of grenades coming through from the vaults, driving through them. This could be a double Faust here.
Oh gosh, the captain goes down there though. What hit that? Was that one of the it looked like one of the infiltration nades? I mean, that was a great load of infiltration nades. They actually timed it with the MG getting in the house, followed it up with an incendiary, and look at that! M20 gets away, barely any health. And what's happening on the left side here? The M10's going for the tier 4.
Osmin went down.
Yeah, I mean, that's a shame there. Like, so much going on. I think that's probably how DevM lost the captain, is just flying.
Oh, and the Rakettan was stolen, so maybe he'll go for the kill in the Panzer headquarters. No, he actually retreats the Rakettan, but that's a massive blow. Jizzleman losing his Osmin. So, you know what, maybe he would have been better off going for a Panzer 4, just so it can trade versus the M10, given that he already had the Panzer headquarters. But it is 50 fuel extra, so it is a significant increase. But yeah, that M10 already having a fantastic time, taking out the Osvin is a massive blow to Jezelin, who's currently behind in pop cap significantly. He doesn't have as many squads, doesn't have the STGs on all of them, so I feel like Jezelin should definitely get those STGs.
Tank battery is ready for deployment. We're seeing another Rakettan come in, of course, very necessary unit at the moment. So the other one's actually taken by DevM, is that correct? Here it is. It's going to be a worry for him.
So many vehicles for DevM. He has the Stuart, the M20 as well, now the M10. So the Cooper's going to have a hard time capping anything. All these squads are going to get forced off very quickly. So I feel like losing that Osmond pretty big swing, but the Rakettan's going to be opening up on the Stuart, taking cover behind the shed, so he should be able to get this one away pretty easily.
Yeah, this is kind of classically going into DevM's hands now at the moment. A nice wide front line. There is veterancy coming up on OKW though, so maybe, you know, as the riflemen don't really have any upgrades as of yet, you know, maybe there's a good opportunity for the Volksgrenadiers, the veterancy, and the SDGs to actually start pushing back a little. Jezelin is coming backward at the moment. I kind of still feel that he's fighting two sides of the map, and I think this may be, a bit of a mistake, really. I think if he focused on one area, focused on some really good flanks, you know, working around the suppression of the MG, I think he could probably do some pretty decent work.
Especially on the right side of Ango, where the VP is so close. It's pretty easy to hold that, even when you do have a hard time. But I guess maybe he doesn't want to venture too far out of his Panzer headquarters, which is giving him a lot of protection right now. Gotta be careful with that retreat against the Sturm Pioneers. They can chase you down very effectively, especially as they get veterancy. DevM, known for his late retreats, but Jezelin, how can he recover from this? He almost has enough resources for his Osvin, just needs to get the manpower loaded up.
Infiltration nades going down, DevM has already spotted it. Another AT gun from Jezelin, so of course I think he's really feeling the pain of that Osvin loss. You know, I think he maybe is even not confident to get another one straight away. I think he feels that he isn't going to be able to reclaim fuel now with that kind of with that build against the M10. So maybe this is a sensible thing, really. Rely on the Rakettans for AT, and then and then work for something bigger. Maybe it'll be a Panther. I think it'll probably be a Panther. I think that's one of his best bets at dealing with the armor threats from Devon. Yeah.
Panthers aren't very good against the M10s though, just because their rate of fire is so low that when you have multiple M10s, which I'm sure DevM will have, it can be a bit difficult to keep it alive. Has DevM actually gone for his Major? No, he hasn't, has he? I'm just surprised he doesn't have more fuel in the bank. But the Mortar's going to have to retreat, gets caught out by the Jaegers.
What's that doing, to be honest? We'll see if the Mortar does retreat. That'll be a nice little win there for Jezelin if it doesn't.
The Americans have cut our supply.
Okay, this bastard's gonna land here. Doesn't have enough damage for the engine to go down though, as the Rakatans were crawling up. Maybe he would have been better off waiting for the ambush to happen, but look, Vet 5 already on the Lord's Grenadier.
We've discussed why that is though, is of course it's actually giving the Faust, even when it doesn't give engine damage, really does kind of give a lot of veterancy. This is something that Talisman actually informed when we've been questioning this. So, you know, getting the Vet 5 on these is really due to spending his munitions in those kind of ways, and these units are really beneficial to it.
We have the 240 mil being deployed. Let's see where it is, maybe on the Panzer headquarters? Oh man, that ISG. The RNG bombs, as they're referred to as, but it's not really that much RNG when you have basically enough to call it down three times, because you will eventually get the job done. It has to be very careful of the retreats, retreating through the barrage area, I suppose, of the RNG bombs. Let's see where it is, because the ISG could get hit.
Oh wow, that's so sneaky. Oh, the Earthwind!
But the timing of that one is so good, because the M20 won't finish the mine off, drops the bazooka on the ground as well. A beautiful play by Jeslin, but not really well timed, as Devim actually gets a squad wipe there. So Jeslin taking a pretty powerful squad loss.
Yeah, that was really unfortunate for Devim. A great little initiative. Really love to see things like that as well. That just went into Jeslin's favour. I'm actually surprised though, because I wasn't expecting him to go for that second option, and I don't think Devim was either. I think that's really why he was so far up there. I think he caught everybody by surprise.
Now, it didn't surprise me, because he had two Rakettans. He wouldn't go double Rakettan if he was going to go for a tank with anti-tank. Like, he wouldn't go two Rakettans and a Jagdpanzer. He would have gone one Rakettan, then he would have gone a Panzer IV, then he would have gone something else. So, I feel like when you have two Rakettans, you can bait so well with the Osvind. Because it's a very juicy target for the M10, and then if you try and chase it down, the double Rakettans ambush you with the cloak. So you can set up those nice little plays there. Rifle could actually go down here to the Osvind, and then when he retreats it a little bit late, but should be in time.
Trying to reclaim his Rakettan work. Look at this guy! There we go.
Actually, it's a good point that someone mentioned in the chat. Has Jezalel not salvaged his Osvind? Because he does have the scavenge doctrine, so he has the thorough salvage. If you go to the Panzer headquarters and see if the wreck is still there. Yeah, it is. He hasn't salvaged it.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that will actually help him get the 105mm howitzer barrage a lot quicker, is that ability. So he does need to really focus on actually making sure everything is salvaged. It's a very, very big boost to the OKW when it comes to the off-map like this. M10 versus Ostwind. Ostwind needs to be careful, but it looks like he's baiting into the Rakettans there. There we go, look at that. Two shots from the Rakettan land first time. Devim maybe didn't notice that then. That was very close to another two shots going off from the Rakettan there.
I don't think he would have had the sight range though, even if he had the attack range. But yeah, you got to be very careful of the M10. When you have a duo of the Rakettan, you just go around cloaking up things. As long as you have infantry support, so you don't get caught by a big rifle flank. But we do see now the Vet 5 logs with the STGs, they are trading very effectively. Until Devim gets some bars. I don't know why he isn't going bars, because the thing is with the Volks is they can't pick up bars if they have the STGs. That being said though, Jezalen has a squad of Volks without STGs, so maybe the reason why he has that is so he actually can pick up some bars if they're dropped.
It's a very interesting one, and also he's spending those munitions on off-map artillery.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe if we see any of the major recon as well. That's a lot cheaper now, and it's only 50 munitions, so... sorry, the recon isn't cheaper. I'm not talking rubbish there. It's the artillery. But
even the recon's not that expensive either.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, it's something he could definitely utilize to place the off-map artillery strikes.
Getting vision for the railway here, 240 mil, that's what he's doing. Yeah, there we go. But he might lose the M10, and that's probably not worth it. Let's see. Because it won't kill the Panzer headquarters. Is it repaired? Look at the health on the Panzer headquarters. Click on the... Okay, so it actually has most health. There goes the ISG. So that was actually a little bit silly there from Jezalen parving the ISG directly through the Panzer headquarters. He should have just gone around it.
Let's see where else it's landed. I even think the Kubel here needs to be careful.
Yeah,
the
exactly.
Scatter on this is really insane. One thing that Devim is doing though, I mean, like 53 pop cap for Jezalen. You know, we've got 70 for Devim, so I mean, he really is out manpowering Jeslin at the moment. It's going to be very difficult for Jeslin to fight back against the USF unless he gets a little more substance on the field. And at the moment, of course, the units that he's using are mainly kind of infantry sections. We're not be seeing the support weapons that are going to be slowing DevM down, so infantry versus infantry, it's heavily in the hands of DevM at this point.
But the double Ostvins, so two Ostvins could completely deny the rifles from having a good time trading versus the OKW infantry. And with no M10, DevM's actually building an M4C Sherman. So that's actually really interesting. I'm surprised he didn't just go for the bulldozer pullings and the M10 spam. The M4A3 Shermans are really nice versus the Ostvins because they don't have much armor, so you can penetrate pretty reliably. As well as the fact that the HE rounds are obviously very powerful. So I like the M4A3 Sherman, but I think maybe just two or three M10s into a bulldozer may have actually been a better choice. But I feel like that was just really greedy there of DevM. Going for the M10, getting the vision for the railway. He got it too, but he lost his M10, which had Vet 1, I believe. And at the moment now, currently DevM doesn't have any anti-Ostvins, so he's a little bit vulnerable.
The site for the 105 howitzer?
Yeah, it's 105. Maybe he wants to cut off the retreat because the Ostvins will be shoving at the squads of infantry.
That's a strange spot for it, I think. Like, what is he...
Well, it's blocking off the retreat path of the lieutenant, and the Ostvin was doing a bit of damage there, so maybe he actually will lose the lieutenant because of that. So it could be a very nice play, but he focuses the retreat. So he will get this one down, but he actually went for that over the lieutenant. Not sure what was the best play there, but definitely that will help because, you know, with only one Sherman, he needs all of the AT he can get. Where are the retreat is here? Because these Ostvins are actually pretty low. He could lose them if the Sherman follows him for long enough.
This one, DevM going in quite hard. He doesn't think that there's any counter near him at the moment. Rifleman was putting a lot of pressure up through the center, so this actually gives him a lot of confidence to use the Sherman in this way. One Ostman will probably definitely go down here. Where are the Rikettans at this point? They're nowhere in the vicinity.
He's up Blitzkrieging. He had Blitzkrieg there. He didn't actually use it. And the Rikettan was decrewed. There were two Rikettans that were taken out by the infantry, so that was the problem there. Is Jezelin, his Rikettans were actually intercepted by the squads of infantry. So it was a really nice play there by DevM, denying the anti-tank, so the Ostvins were a little bit vulnerable there. And that was the Vet 2 Ostvin that actually went down, so now it's only back to Vet 0. Bazooka on the vault, and the Rakan comes through as well here, but does get the killing blow. So now DevM is back to having no armor on the field. He will now have no mobile counter to the Ostvin.
That's some really good trading there, I think. And that is a good evener for Jezelin. 52 pop cap from 52 now.
Look at the VPs.
Yeah, but the VPs are very, very in a bad situation. I can agree on that, but let's just focus on the positive.
Yeah, he's actually spawned Jaeger out here of the forward garrison, so we can try and take that down. I think Jezelin is in a decent spot, but I don't think he can actually hold these VPs. Yeah, he got triple capped for too long. Jezelin, I think he maybe should have prioritized that right-hand side of the VP more, because it's so close to his base, so you can generally hold it pretty easily, especially if you put some booby traps there from the Jaegers. The VP does get stalled, so Jezelin, he can't actually take that one. We'll have to retreat his Jaegers, and I feel like that's going to be GG here. Only 30 VPs down. And this is actually a really surprising game, because we know that DevM isn't a VP player. We talked to him before, he's really not concerned about the VPs, and yet this game, he actually played around the VPs, or rather, Jezelin neglected them. So, that was, I think perhaps it was a deceptively not close game, because it actually looked really close, and the engagements were, but Jezelin, he just didn't focus the VPs, and I feel like he didn't need to get all of the VPs, but he needed to have one VP on the right side. The VP was, you know, again, it's pretty easy to hold, but Jezelin spread himself maybe a little bit too thin. He kept trying to, as you say, like, go to the left side, go to the right side, hold his cutoff. But with how much pressure DevM was constantly putting, it was making it very hard for Jezelin to actually hold the VP. So very well played by DevM.
The thing that got it for me, I mean, the tier 4, this was something that went up, and I thought this went up, like, a little bit early, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Now we understand why he's done it. Of course, the range, as you can see here. So he's trying to defend his strategic point. He's trying to defend against DevM, kind of coming up this left-hand side of the map. But to be honest, for how the game was going, I mean, DevM pretty much nearly always owned this side of the map. So there really wasn't any problems losing this territory.
Yeah.
You know, where Jezelin initially controlled, which was the right side, he left that side. Yeah, he let Dev take the right side. That was the point for me at least, where I thought this is a mistake. If he'd have dominated two buildings here and just kind of put the front line here, I think he would have had a much easier game.
What if he actually put his Panzer headquarters over here? Then that would have been even easier for him to actually hold the VP.
Yeah.
But I think ultimately the biggest blow there for Jezlin is when he lost that first Osvin. We didn't actually capture it on screen because there was a bit of other action happening at the time, but losing that initial Osvin, that really did set him back, because generally against US, because they have the free squads, because they have the riflemen, you're generally going to be behind in infantry battles, especially because you have to build the Rakens pretty early on. So you are pretty reliant on having that vehicle, the Osvin, to force away the riflemen and put the trades in your favor. Yeah. But when he lost that Osvin to the M10 dive, then all of a sudden he couldn't stem the infantry, the riflemen and such. But it was actually a really close game. I was definitely impressed with Jezlin's early game. He just needs to be a little bit more focused in terms of his VP control. But the next game, it's probably started by now, actually, since we were on a 5-minute delay. So let's see if we can jump into that one.
Let's have a look, yeah. So I've seen a couple of you just saying, can we lower the in-game music down? I've taken that down a little bit. That's not a problem. I am reading the comments. It's a bit difficult en masse, but we definitely are paying attention. thank you, Stark, and hello, by the way. There was somebody who's been wanting a shout out for most of the stream.
Cool. By the way, I should clarify that General's Gentleman in chat is not actually me. That's Archon Hawk.
Yeah, I know.
From Perth. But my hands are here. I can't talk on chat while I'm actually casting. But it's good to have some moderators in here. But yeah, what do you think of the scavenge? Do you think it was the best choice?
I don't know. Difficult. Like, Jezlin puts a lot of emphasis on scavenge because he thinks obviously that's like one of the best commanders. He actually said yesterday in the interview, like, you can't survive
without
Okado.
Yeah.
Okay, no. He was like, everything else is just you know, it's just rubbish. So actually I don't think there was any doubt of what he was going to pick there at all. I actually like it. The double Raketen Ostwind, I think it's something that we used to see Jove play. We used to see Jove play that kind of thing on Kolodny Firma during ESL, and it was a really, really good strategy, especially when Dev isn't going to tech up to you know, any kind of like weaponry for his infantry squads, especially when he hasn't got something like the Calliope there. You know, he just had the M10s. Like, I think that could be a good build, because the Ostwinds are a perfect bait to bait into a Raketen backline.
Especially since the Ostwinds actually get combat blitz at Vet 1, which gives them not only more speed, but it also gives them the received accuracy bonus. Yep. So it actually means you have a pretty high chance of missing the Ostwind. And that's actually something that Jezlin didn't do. We saw in that engagement when he had the double Ostwind being hunted down by that M4A3 Sherman, is he actually didn't pop the combat blitz. And that may have kept his Vet 2 Ostwind alive. So...
yeah,
Jezlin definitely didn't play that game perfectly. Neither did DevM, of course. But I feel like, DevM needs to play better. I mean, that's obviously a redundant statement, pretty obvious. But when you're versing DevM, is what I'm saying, is you can't make these mistakes because DevM will punish you for it.
Yeah. Equally, though, you know, in terms of engagements, it wasn't a perfect game for DevM. He lost the rifleman early on. That rifleman went down to kind of that freak shots from the Volksgrenadiers and the Jaegerlite infantry. You know, they went down. Of course, we saw the mortar as well. That mortar nearly went down. The mortar was lucky to get out. I don't know if you saw, like, the retreat.
But
it's the wheel of RNG. Actually, did we have any of
the RNG? No, we didn't.
We did have an abandon, actually. The Kubel got abandoned.
Did it?
Yeah, Kubel got abandoned. Okay. The Ostwind drove into it and died, and the Kubel didn't.
Right.
The Kubel that ultimately finished off the Ostwind.
And there wasn't any tank wipes. Maybe there was like a Stuart that got a squad of Volks or something like that.
Yeah.
That was actually a really good game, though. I was actually very impressed by how Jezlin played that early game. But we're going to have the game number 2, which will also be on Angoville, and it will be the faction swap. We know that DevM will definitely be playing Wehrmacht. He only plays Wehrmacht as far as Axis is concerned. And Jezlin is playing the Soviets. I feel like this is actually going to be a very different matchup, because you have now two factions that both have very strong access to flamers, mortars, more of a combined arms approach. Could even see some snipers come out. I know we'll definitely see DevM go for the sniper. The sniper isn't as strong against Soviets as it is against US in particular, because you have the six-man squads, they're cheaper to reinforce, you have the URA, so you can hunt down the sniper pretty well. But still, DevM will go for it. His sniper micro is amazing. As for Jezelin, I wonder how he plays this. I think, actually, con spam is very nice against DevM. We've seen players like Talisman, I believe, who versus DevM.
Yeah.
Con spam and con spam.
That hasn't always worked, though. If Assbag was... we call him Pudding Bag, obviously, yeah. In the tournament scene.
Gardening Pudding
you
Bag.
You remember as Assbag. But, I mean, it's... He tried that, and he famously lost to DevM in under 5 minutes because of the in ESL. DevM beat the con spam with Oster or something in a 5 minute game. So I would be surprised if that was
viable. Well, I mean, it's obviously it's not going to be a free win, because you're versing DevM and he's an amazing player and he has great sniper micro. What I am trying to say is that I think con spam is the best approach against DevM's axis, because he's all about the sniper. And, like, can you think of a better strategy against the sniper than con spam? Maybe you could say something about M3s, but, you know, M3s are very hard to depend on because the 2-2-2 comes out pretty quick. You can get fausted pretty easily if the grenadiers are nearby. So I think I would love to see con spam, especially if Jezelin goes the tank hunter tactics. PTRS are actually insanely powerful against infantry. They actually do a lot more than what you would think. PTRS aren't necessarily a downgrade against infantry, so if you have a lot of cons with a lot of PTRS, you can get some pretty good damage done, and then it will pretty much shut down any use of the scout car and the flame half track if DevM wants to go for that.
Let's have a look at the commanders as well, quickly. Now, DevM, we spoke in the interview. If you guys haven't seen the interview yesterday, I wouldn't obviously recommend checking it out now because you want to watch the tournament. But basically, we were discussing mobile defense and its kind of necessity. So, of course, that's in the loadout. Lightning War, absolutely
nice commander.
Great. I really hope we get to see this. Of course, it just doesn't give Austere the kind of early CP off-map tanks that you're used to kind of counter the T-70, the SU-76. So... you know, we're probably going to see one of these mechanized assault or mobile defense. I personally think mechanized assault. We were speaking about the late game Tiger being a necessity for Axis, and you know, Jezelin, it's probably just guard mode.
It's kind of a spectrum, really, where you have mobile defense, mechanized, and lightning war. It's basically lightning war is the best late game, mobile defense is the best early game, and then in the middle is mechanized because you still have the Tiger.
Yeah,
but you don't have the...
okay, let's just intro quickly as well, just for YouTube purposes. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Game 2 of the Warpaint Championship Finals. We've just seen DevM take Game 1 against Jezelin, and what was a pretty good match on Angerville. Now we have Jezelin playing as the Soviets from the south side. He's going to go straight into a Tier 1 build there. And, of course, DevM, who's playing as his favorite faction, Austere, from the north side.
Yeah, this actually really surprises me. Jezelin going for a quick tier 1, and Penals are insanely powerful. Penals, a lot of people say they're OP, I would probably agree with them as well. Penals are so strong. The problem is, though, is that Penals are actually countered pretty hard by the Sniper, because they are of an expensive squad. They do have the manpower bleed if they get constantly picked off by the Sniper. They don't have URA until Vet 2, so they're not as strong against the Sniper as what you would see from Conscripts, but they are insanely good against Grenadiers and Panzer Grenadiers. So Jezelin, he needs to try and really play around the Sniper. What does he do? Maybe he tries to keep the Penals away from being out in the open, so he always has the shot blockers behind him, so the snipers can't really engage. I feel like this game really comes down to the sniper. How much damage can DevM get with the sniper, and how much damage can Jezelin mitigate by his good positioning and decision making?
Well, we haven't seen that sniper come in yet. We're actually seeing a heavy grenadier build at the moment, so...
It'll come in. It'll come
in. It's usually something he does early,
yeah,
though,
you're right.
Which is odd. It's a little bit of a curveball. Maybe he's trying to throw in a curveball to Jezelin here.
He won't.
He won't do it.
Look, I mean, to be honest, like you're trying to hype this up, but let's be honest, it is DevM. DevM is not a player that experiments. He's not a player that really does innovate. He's very methodical. He's very...
You've called me out, Gigi. I'm just trying to make something exciting for the community.
I know. Like, how dare you
just slam it down? Don't be excited, everybody. Yeah. It's just Devem. He's going to do the same thing you've seen him do every other time we've seen him play. Watch his next victim.
To be fair, it will be funny if he actually does skip the sniper. But Jezzan actually going for the M3. So this is his answer. This is what he has planned. And the M3, it can be spectacular against the sniper if you get a nice retreat path, especially if you have the flame engineers. But the M3s are always hard to rely on, just because if DevM keeps the sniper nearby, if his grenadiers, then you can't really use the M3 aggressively because of the Panzerfaust. And not even just that, the 2-2-2, it does come out pretty quickly, and it is a very strong hard counter. DevM is going for the sniper, which surprised no one here, but already pretty good map control for DevM. When you do go for the tier 1, especially when you go for the M3, it does limit your squads early on.
Yeah, I think we saw that actually. DevM had 3 squads on the field before the Penal Battalions came out. So, you know, that's a very strong Ostis start really over it. But the good thing actually with the Penals is they build very quickly. They build very well. And if you complement it with guards, as we see guard modes of coordination has been picked by Jezzan, I think you have a very, very good... very good potential there of units. The guards are a really good complement to Penal Battalions.
I think we can both agree that guard modo is hands down the best commander for Soviets. It's just so good in so many ways. The mortar's going to be really nice on this map. You have a lot of garrisons to flush out. Flamer's actually being popped here by the Pioneers. I do love that. You really want to have the garrison clearing on a map with this many houses.
Yeah, the other thing as well is the flames, they seem to do a lot of the health reduction on those squads. It's going to force Jezzan to get the medical supplies, get the medics on his base. So again, like, you know, forcing your opponent to constantly spend manpower. Of course, you know, there could have been a chance that the engagements would not have had so much health loss, and he could have just kept reinforcing them. But now he's actually forced, really, to use the medics there. So Devim's just constantly getting like one up over Jezzan here, and I think that's going to stack up pretty quickly. I don't know what this conscript squad is doing here. It's very, very risky against Devim.
Devim's playing this very well. Notice he's always keeping his sniper nearby a squad of Karens. He will not put the sniper out of position when he has the M3 on the field. So we have 2 squads of Grens now, so definitely the sniper can poke away here at these infantry. Actually merging the Penals is very nice. Keeping the Penals on the field, getting those powerful damage from those rifles. Actually, the problem with that though is that the conscripts have a much lower received accuracy. So merging the conscripts, the squad won't be as durable, but when they're that cheap, it's not really a big deal. So the map control is still pretty even. We see the VP score is actually already in the favour of DevM again. I believe last game it was 476. So DevM has managed to secure himself faction selection, game number 3.
It's already quite an important turn of events there. I think actually though, it doesn't really matter the faction selection for Jezzan, because as we know, Devem said he would rather play...
Exactly!
He'd rather play Axis. If he has faction selection, he's going to pick Oster. So like, faction selection is not a huge thing. Jezzan, of course, just needs to focus on actually making sure that these games go in his favour. The question is, how is he going to answer this sniper at the moment? Because Devem is, of course... And I think we should watch this sniper play, because Devem is a pro sniper player. He labels that this really is the only thing keeping Austere as a viable faction. This is actually what he says about the sniper. So we will kind of watch how he really utilizes this effectively.
Look at Jezzan's float of manpower. He really wants multiple guards, or maybe even a quick mortar and a quick squad of guards. He doesn't want to overinvest in the penals. Yeah, see, look at that. He goes for a mortar and for a squad of guards immediately. So I loved how he floated that up. He's going to have a really good all-rounded composition. Now he has the guards for the anti-vehicle, he has the mortar to flush out the MG and then dislodge the grenadiers.
This is really dangerous. Of course, the sniper's not here anymore, but the Penal Battalion still needs to retreat. Look at this though, scout car going over. This is a great push. There's no mines yet, and the sniper is actually running to a position where it could be targeted.
Oh, what?
That was nearly a big mistake. Jezzan hits the retreat button immediately,
That's only a Pyro squad. There's no Grenadiers there. He will lose the Sniper, maybe even the MG as well. This is a massive swing here for Jezzelin. The Penals are there. He can satchel the Med Bunker. He should do this. He should evac and satchel the Med Bunker. That would be an amazing play to make. No, he actually drives out. Why? He can just retreat the Penals there. I feel like that's a massive missed opportunity.
I don't know, I think he still got the main win out of that, which was the Sniper, and of course, as we know, Devon will pretty much always rebuild that Sniper, so he's now forced a 360 manpower issue onto Devon, which is a really, really nice play. And here we go, we may even see another wipe here.
No.
The flame damage. Do we have any Grenadiers coming down? The MG set up in position. Devon, I don't know if he wants to push it or not. I think it's a sensible choice not to.
Oh, nice MG. But what? The Penals get the last shot.
Actually.
And the Grens go down. And this was actually a massive mistake here for DevM. He spread himself too thin. The Scalper will arrive now and get that M3 down. We actually have guards in the house, so maybe the M3 won't go down. Yeah, nice little recovery there with the guards. So DevM, he didn't keep his Sniper nearby the Grens. Exactly. The one time the Grenadiers weren't there for support, the M3 went in, got the killing blow, and got out. And even the Grenadiers on the right side were overextended. The M3 scout car, it's a pretty big investment because it's 15 fuel. It gives you a lot of early game impact. But the moment the 222 shows up, the M3 is pretty much useless. You can't really do anything. But the 222, it was about 20 seconds delayed. DevM, he should have just kept his forces together until he had the scout car, and then once he got the scout car, then he can spread out. Then he can kind of try and cap different parts across the map and be a bit more aggressive, a bit more mobile. But now DevM losing two squads, his Sniper in particular, suffering a disastrous set of losses.
Yeah, and also we're seeing some great play for Jezzelin here. I really feel like he's just become empowered by that. The HM120 pushing away the MG. The guards rocking up the field now. They're going to be able to get a couple of shots off on the scout car. This is great. Like, the whole army has had to be retreated from DevM there, and nearly gets the scout car as well. Now he's going to be able to decap DevM from the entire map at the moment, leaving DevM with no territories. Now, you and I know this isn't really something that concerns DevM too much. He's not really that fussed about territories. He's more fussed about engagements. But look at this. He's having to rebuild the Sniper. I don't personally think that is how he should be spending his manpower right now. But this is DevM. We don't question DevM. He knows that this is part of the full game build that he needs to win. And this is where, personally, I think Jezzelin has the best opportunity of beating DevM. I think this is the situation we could see that happen.
Yeah, this game is over. I think he does need the Sniper, though, because if not for the Sniper, how else does he trade versus the Guards? The Grenadiers won't trade versus the Guards. They don't have... they both don't have the upgrades, and even if they do, the DPs and the PTRS are so powerful. Jezzelin now, all he has to do is just go for a T-34-85 spam. He doesn't need a T-7, he already has the map control. He already has DevM pushed back all the way into his base. So he doesn't have to go for a light vehicle. I mean, he may do against the Sniper in particular, but I feel like going for 85s is really all he needs to do.
Well, we'll see if he does make that decision. The second scout car... The scout car is repaired. Do you think the scout car is going to be able to change this? I mean, it's not going to perform well against the guards, but we do know that DevM is very good at kind of switching sides. The guards haven't really been splitting up. They've always kind of been in the same rough vicinity. So I don't know if that scout car really has the capacity to help him or not here. The AT gun's coming out from DevM, so maybe he does think that the T-70 is going to be out from Jezzelin. It's building, so I think that's the decision he's gone for. I personally think that's a good idea. I know we may actually disagree on this one, but I do think that one thing that Jezzelin maybe even suffered from in the last game was the early tech up. Like, I think you always need to have that vehicle there, at least, so that you can continue to put up this front line. Because otherwise, it's possible that DevM could come up with a mid-game strategy in the time before the H5s come out. And start to push the territory down.
I think it may actually force DevM into a Puma, which would definitely benefit Jezzelin in that regard. It's a very late T-70, it's 12 minutes now, essentially, so DevM already has a pack, he already has a scout car, so there are actually some counters to the T-70, and given how little map control DevM has. He's not going to have his squads overextended. He won't be caught out of position because he's kind of clumped up together and there's this one group of units going to hold one VP, which is nice. I like how DevM is not being too optimistic. He's only trying to hold the VP, not going to the left side, not getting caught out of position. So we'll see. Jezlin, he almost has enough to mark targets, and the scout car has to be so careful against the guards. A lot of munitions in the bank as well here, so we can use a button. I shouldn't use a nade on that house. And no dodge! Oh, a little bit late there. The pioneers almost go down to the flamer as well from the penis.
Yeah, and really what a strong combination too. We were talking a little bit before about penals and guards, which are a very popular combination at the moment, but they do just kind of get the one up on Oster so quickly because, they're, you know, as we've seen before, you know, this is why we've seen DevM choose mobile defense, because, you know, his own opinion, from what he said yesterday in that interview, you know, the Puma is absolutely essential in being able to keep Oster in the game against the early T70, well, not even the early T70, even the late T70 requires that. In DevM's own opinion, he said himself he thinks this impacts Oster's late game. And we're going to see now if this is an opportunity that Jezlin can take advantage of.
Yeah,
I think given that these two players have had that discussion, Jezlin may be feeling pretty good right now about what's going
to
happen.
I feel like DevM's kind of lost his chance in the late game now because he had to go for mobile defense. He's not going to have the Tigers, he's not going to have the Lightning War, the JU-87 Strafe. The pack actually gets decrewed there, so close to the base though, it's not really a big deal, but the triple cap is currently on here for Jezlin, so this game can get closed out pretty quickly if he actually holds on to it. And let's see if Jezlin, if he has his tier 4 yet. I don't think he does, but he's not too far off it. Maybe Jezlin will go for a caddy, just given how contained DevM is. He can't really spread his forces out.
I am really liking the use of the T-70 here. It's very reserved, and of course, you know, knowing that the AT gun is there for DevM, he's using the guards to keep away the light vehicles and the infantry. The HM120 is just harassing this unit. It's harassing the MG. It's harassing the sniper. And of course, did either of them get that in the RNG wheel?
No. They got it was abandoned and it was a tank wipe.
Right.
So no mortar clump wipes. It was an option on the RNG wheel.
Wait.
Whoa! Speaking of, yeah, there
as
you go.
We're talking about it. There it is, the first one. This is an interesting one. Why is the T-70 retreating from this engagement? Probably has a really good chance there. The AT gun was decrewed. We heard that a minute ago over the radio there. Guards coming in, nearly get line of sight on the scout car. In fact, he's going to push it a little bit more. He's going to go for that building.
Oh,
he's also going to force the sniper away as well. Scout car has to be very careful in this situation. Button,
yeah, nice.
On.
There we go.
Yeah,
go down for sure.
It's gotta go down. Oh no, smoke has popped actually. So a good save from DevM there. Smoke from the mobile defense used to rescue the scout car. The Puma is available as well. So here we go. Jezlin pushes too far here. DevM, his finger maybe on the button. We have lost
an MG team. T-70 definitely putting more pressure on, getting the pyos, getting the MG down. DevM's he's playing fiercely here. A lot of money on the line, so you definitely can't blame him. The stakes are high, but I mean this game is pretty damn over. DevM actually putting a second sniper. I mean, I like that though because the sniper has a lot of range, so you don't have to get near the T-70 to do any damage. You can kind of sit back safely at a distance, poke away some models. DevM just needs to try and hold the right side VP. Going to the left side, he can't hold it because it's going to be manpower bleed. He risks the T-70 wiping things on retreat. It's what can we say to this almost? Is this game is over. It has been for quite a while.
It is, yeah. I think DevM is still going to try for a dominant engagement. I think that's where his strength will come in now. He's just started to switch sides. He really needs to hit before Jezlin decides to get tier 4 off. Something which, actually, Jezlin seems in no rush to do whatsoever. And I actually think that is going to be a bit of a problem. If DevM can kind of make a really hard push now, let's just say Puma comes on the field, Puma wipes the T-70, you know, Command Panzer IV is dealing with the guards, two snipers as well. Actually, no, he cancelled the other sniper. But, you know, like, without the tier 4 units, then what is Jezlin going to be doing? Is this going to be pushed back off the map?
It's actually good timing, because there's currently no anti-tank here for for Jezzelin. He has a lot of fuel saved up, so his tier 4 is perhaps a little too late. But it's just a matter of time until the T-34-85 shows up with Mark Target. He's going to take that P4 down incredibly easily, especially if we have the support of the button from the guards. Though it is actually really hard to use button against this commander, because you have the Panzer Tactician, a very, very powerful ability, which does give this commander decent late game in the sense that you can keep those tanks alive. We have actually button being called down. This guard squad's very low here, so he has to be careful about this retreat path.
And it does give chase as well. Once again, there's really nothing stopping it here. MG is going to have to retreat as well. The T-70 may be able to come around the back a little bit. With a little support from the guards, it's definitely a viable option. But no, T-70 is still harassing the left-hand side. There we go, tier 4 is actually now nearly complete. So, he's actually on form to win this still, I think, with that tech up. Yeah. I was really worried that he wasn't going to tech up to tier 4, and whether he was forgetting that because he's like furiously trying to hold off DevM,
yeah.
Or whether that was a conscious decision, but actually to see that, and to see that DevM is actually having to build pioneers.
Yeah, that's rough.
You know, that is... this game has got to go to Jezzelin, really.
Definitely.
I think it would be that would be the biggest shock here, actually, is if Jezzelin fails to win from what is quite frankly one of the best situations he could be in.
I mean, DevM isn't Barton. He isn't the king of comebacks. I don't think we're really seeing DevM have that many amazing comebacks. But actually, we saw one against Talisman, but that was really about him. But there's no way you can recover from this, especially when you have mobile defense again. If he went Lightning War, then perhaps he could have, but he wouldn't have had this command Panzer IV, so he wouldn't have had this little bit of surge of map control. See, the T-70 does wipe a squad of Grens. That unit is just so overpowered. He can wipe squads effortlessly. Retreat was a little bit late there, unfortunately, from DevM, but definitely getting punished for his...
The sniper's being built again! I really like... Yeah, you know. We were saying this before, DevM will always build a sniper. You know, like T-34 sniper, which do you feel has the more use? We'll leave that question as a rhetoric, but... this is just a wait now. I don't even feel like... DevM probably knows what's coming. I think he's too... You know, he doesn't really want to hit the surrender button. So I think he's just going to quietly wait out his VP drain of one per second for 2 minutes.
He had a chance, but he kept losing squads. If he played perfectly and didn't lose anything, then obviously he had a chance of coming back, but with how much pressure Jezzelin has been constantly putting on and keeping him contained, keeping his squads low and getting reinforced, but he comes to 85, that P4 isn't even fully repaired yet. So he's a little bit scared of the pack, but the T-34 should go for the kill here. No, let's him back off. He has all three VPs. We know Jezzelin isn't a player who would take risks like this. We asked him about RNG, and when we said, what do you have to say to the players that do complain about RNG? And he just said, just don't make risks. Like, why would you go for a risk when you can just play the VPs? But when you have a triple drain on your opponent, when you're going to win in only a couple of minutes, then why would you leave it to RNG to decide the game when you can just guarantee your win 100% by playing passively?
Speaking of other things you wouldn't normally do, what is this skin about? This is the Warpaint Championship. We have winter skins on summer maps.
Yeah.
Which are... what does he have for this?
Yeah, this is best of 5, for those of you who asked in the chat. So it will be 1-1 after this game by the looks of it, but it will be best of 5. So the first to 3 wins. We're going to see... DevM actually push up the left side here, but even if he secures the left side, there's only one VP there, so it's not going to work even in the best of situations.
Yeah, he'd have to do something pretty spectacular at this point. The second 85 is about to hit the field as well. DevM's building another sniper. I think what DevM may be doing, though, is practicing against this strategy.
Yeah.
I think DevM's trying to think, right, how am I going to come against this build? It's most likely Jezzelin is going to... That's a dead sniper. It's most likely that Jezzelin would use this again.
Was that sniper on full health?
I'm not sure. I believe it may have been. I mean, it's a HM 120. When the shots land, it feels like artillery.
Yeah. Because a regular mortar can't one-shot a sniper. The heavy mortar probably can. But anyway, you're going to see a push up to the right side, but we have the double 85s moving in. So Gentleman is going to be able to hold this pretty easily, even the Panzer IV command tank getting reloaded here. I think it's actually a demo on the VP. So the Pioneers can go down pretty easily. Yeah, demo went off the Pioneers. It's a Puma, but there's still guards in that house. We go down there, we just get out of the house in time. There's the Panzer IV. GG.
Devon does surrender. Leaves it to 8 VPs for his surrender. Yeah. Well, a good game, and how great to see Jezlin
bring it back,
game
yeah.
2. Like, really, Jezlin, even himself, has been saying he is the underdog, do you know what I mean? Devon was so confident about the games, do you know what I mean? And it's absolutely great to see him. So it's 1-1 at this point. Great strategies from Jezlin, rocking the meta, you know, and of course, one thing we spoke with Dev M about, I don't know if you remember this, was that he doesn't know the meta. That's why
he doesn't care. He is apathetic.
He really does say that he plays his own style, and he doesn't watch people who are streaming the meta. He doesn't watch anything like that. He doesn't kind of download replays and study the opponent. He just plays his own thing. So
I believe he studies his opponent in a tournament, but he doesn't try and work out, like, you know, what's the most common command. Is he just says, like, I will try and see what works the best for me. But yeah, I think what you're alluding to is that, you know, he doesn't have as much practice dealing with very, very meta things, and guard motor coordination is as meta-y as you get. I mean, it is meta 101, because it's just so strong. But it's unfortunate, because Devam, he had such a bad early game. Mm. He absolutely deserved to lose that sniper. He got caught out of position. The sniper was nowhere near his grenadiers. The grenadiers as well, there was a squad capping up the right side. And you always have to consider, like, when you're versing the M3 scout car, it is an investment. It's 15 fuel, and it will delay your light vehicles. The T-70 was very late. It's a fair bit of manpower that can go down very quickly, especially when the scout car, the 222, arrives. And DevM, all he had to do was just wait about 30 seconds or a minute, and then once he had the 222, then he could be a lot more aggressive, split up his forces. But he tried to do too much. And Devam, or rather Jezelin, he waited until he had the moment. His M3 was very cautious. He didn't go in until he found a weakness. The MG was isolated in that garrison with the flamer penals. He could wipe him out. And the sniper was next to the garrison. So finding the sniper was serendipity. It was a happy accident that he went for the MG, and he was like, oh, whoop, there's a sniper there, fantastic, I'll dive that instead. So yeah, Devam not playing that early game well. You can talk about Ostia being weak as much as you'd like, but when you do make mistakes that are that crucial, it definitely, you will get punished for it.
Yeah, it's difficult. This mobile defense thing as well, he didn't need to pick that one. He could have gone for the Stug E, and I think that's more of a better choice, yep, because it has the anti-infantry and enough to deal with the T-70. The decision to go Puma, but not actually take the Puma, he wanted to build another sniper. I will ask him about this in a second. I think, because we're actually having the... We're going to do like a little break for the players, and also just have a quick summary of what's happening at the moment. Shall I go and get them?
I think Kyle is. I mean, you can grab them if you
I'll
want.
Quickly go and grab them, so give me a second.
But yeah, basically what's happening is we're going to have a bit of a mid-series thought breakdown where we ask them about their thoughts, how the games went, explain some thought processes behind some things. This won't be too long, and they will have a bit of a break to calm themselves, to think over their mistakes, reflect upon the games and how they want to improve this and go on to the next series. And this is where your ability to play in a competitive setting really matters. Because after getting completely wrecked, I guess we will say wrecked, by your opponent that hard, it can be really nerve-wracking. When you're in a tournament setting, there's $1,000 on the line.
Cut the stream, there's pizza.
There's pizza?
There's pizza.
Oh, man.
Stop the tournament.
Well, mid-sentence, I have reconsidered my priorities, and, pizza is what I want.
So what we're going to do, actually, because it's a best of five, this could be long games, this could go on for a while, and of course the players want breaks as well. We normally allow like a 15-minute between breaks, and the players will call for one. So we're going to move you over to a wait screen, we're going to cram some pizza down just very, very quickly. Players going to be able to just kind of freshen up, get their heads back in game for game number three. We're going to do a little quick talk with them as well, and then we'll roll into game three fairly shortly. So, guys, all 700 plus of you at the moment, thanks for tuning in. We'll be back very, very shortly, I promise. We'll get into the game as soon as possible. So, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. guys. We will be live again in a couple of seconds. Sorry to keep you waiting. Alright, hello everyone, we are back. Players have had a little break. Me and GG have eaten some pizza, everybody's happy. Guys, game 1 and 2 are now finished. We currently sit at one game each. How have the games gone for you so far? What's been happening?
Well, game 1 went mostly as planned, excluding a bit of the early game that I let Jeslin have some control of the houses. And game 2 was just completely horrible, and I lost a sniper, and coming back from that is really difficult on a map with so many buildings that Soviets can use to basically close the map.
Yeah. And Jeslin, like, game 2, like, was so strong for you. What do you think was, like, the real winning formula there?
Well, I played it very good, because I know that Devem always do the same strategy with 3 grands and a sniper. And then he skipped to T2 and build a 2-2-2.
Yeah.
So
you planned for that then, everything. Yeah.
I had luck because I rushed with my M3, his base,
yes.
And I killed his sniper.
Yes, yeah. We saw that was like probably one of the tipping points of the game.
Yeah, I played very solid, but in the first game, I felt good in the first minutes, but after his M20, I started to lose units.
Yeah, I think we both thought that one of the things that happened in that first game was you had like the right side of the map, you had the resources, and then you kind of shifted left to try and counter Devemo's activity,
yes,
on that side,
and
then you lost.
I was so nervous because, I don't know, this is my first time doing this thing, but now I feel more comfortable.
Good, good. We just saw a second ago. So Devem believes he's drunken his secret weapon now, which is apparently a coffee. Apparently that is the secret tool that we're all missing. How have you prepared for your third game?
No.
Kinder Bueno. Just clean as you had a was it a Kinder Bueno?
Yeah.
So there we go. Coffee for Devem, Kinder Bueno for Jeslin. Before we get into the next game, of course we're going to spin the wheel of RNG again.
Yes,
I feel like we should have some jazzy music.
But before we go on, I noticed when you went into the base with the M3 and the penals, did you think about actually evacuating the penals and satcheling the med bunker? That would have been a really nice play.
I was thinking about killing the sniper.
So you didn't think about the med bunker?
No, because, you know, there are few time, and I was trying to kill the sniper.
Yeah, okay, fair enough.
Get in, get out.
I think that would have been a really good play to make if you did that, though.
It's something you can't always do, though, do you know what I mean? The heat of the moment.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
But the main thing was, like, the sniper, I suppose, when it got killed. Are we...
Let's do it.
Let's do it. Let's...
I guess you can kind of see it on camera, can't you?
Yeah, we did actually have the RNG pull through as well. We were talking about it. We were saying, where's the RNG squad wipe from the tank? Your T-70 then killed his pioneers in one shot. It's fantastic. Brilliant. So let's do the first one. Do you want to go for spin the wheel? Yep, that's cool.
Alright, Jeslin.
Okay, let's go.
This is like so esports.
Oh, abandoned again! Oh, abandoned. Okay, second one. Devem.
Right, so let's see.
This was the best idea, wasn't it?
Like, we just think, why do they have this at Relic? You know,
what do we have here from Devem? Oh, he's gonna have a recon plane crash land.
I don't think that's what happened.
Okay. There we go.
So
this may not happen. Yeah. Don't get too excited about this one. But there we go. The RNG wheel has spoken. Guys, good luck in your game 3s. Games 1 and 2 are like awesome. So good luck.
Yeah, good luck and fun. I'm definitely keen to see how these players play now that they've warmed up they've got themselves in the atmosphere and the mentality. And actually, we did talk about this in our interview. We said, you know, playing in a competitive setting when there's so much on the line, money, fame, glory, women, all, you know, all those things. How do you prepare yourself? How do you manage your emotions? How do you manage your focus? And obviously, they didn't do as good of a job as they needed to in terms of managing their nerves, which we saw.
I think like the situations are weird as well, as you heard Jeslin just say. Like, this is his first time that he's done this kind of thing. You know, he's flown to another country. He's, you know, he's not like as well spoken English as say everyone else here. So, you know, this is maybe like slightly overwhelming for him. But you know, we definitely saw after that first game him pick up. Like he picked up a lot after the first game. Do you know what I mean? There were no real silly movements or anything. It was all kind of played like really solidly. So the one thing that concerned me, like, we were just out there having a quick break and Devem's drinking the Starbucks cup coffee and he's like, just so that you know, this is my secret weapon.
Yeah.
And he said, when I drink coffee, he's like, this is how I get through the qualifiers.
Right.
Yeah. And so now, according to Devem, this next game should be absolutely intense.
You know what was really nice to hear, what I really enjoyed was actually the confidence that Jeslin now had. Because when we spoke to him yesterday, Devem was very cocky. He was very confident of himself, and Jeslin was like, "Oh well, you know, I'll try my best. I'll see how we go. Yeah. I'm just here to have fun. That's what it's all about." But now he's like, "I played really well. I played solid. I'm feeling confident." And you know, I think it's a good time to be a Jeslin fanboy right now.
Yeah. It's always been a good time to be a Jeslin fan because he's such a nice guy. Do you know what I mean? He's always just been like a player in the community. He just keeps to himself. You know, he just plays well, puts on a good show, and that's Jeslin. And like, it's so. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's so good, really, to see him there. And of course, these are the best of kind of two worlds of really dominant play. Like Devem, just absolutely, you know, huge name in the community, especially when it comes to Heroes 1, and Jeslin, who just, like, topped KOTU when it launched for, like, 2 years, like, winning all of the tournaments. So, it's good. It is, it's a good time to be a Jeslin fanboy.
Yeah.
But, of course, we've got a potential 3 games to go, or at least 2 now, I think. Is that right?
Well, there's at least best 2, of 5, yeah. So whoever wins 2 more games will take this one.
Oh yes. Let's have a look what Twitch chat is saying as well. Let's try and have a look. If anyone has any like questions or things they want to say, we can also do shout outs now. We're just waiting for game 3 to start. So if you guys want any shout outs or anything, tag Relic Entertainment in your comment, and we'll try and get through them the best we can before the game starts. Which I am still checking for.
Stormless, I want Machine's shirt. Well, the good news is, if you go to generalsgentleman.spreadshirt.com, you can buy your own and get it posted out to you. So, yeah. But no, it's a lot of fun here. This is basically, like, all I have is these shirts. Like, yeah. Stormless can confirm. Like,
yeah.
I went for a shower yesterday, and you were like, only the Machine would, like, walk out of the shower with the same shirt.
Yeah, pretty much,
like,
yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
It's like, actually, I have
all
this
all
vast
you have
variety
packed
of all these different rainbow-coloured shirts that all have GG logo on them.
All you've packed is GG shirts. It's crazy.
And my GG hoodie, of course.
We've got a shout-out for Stormless. Hey, yes, okay, that's me. We've got Sturm Tiga Gaddafi with a Coco Jumbo. Hell yeah.
Ah, yes.
Do you know when Warpaint contributors will get the faceplate decal and theme skin for Milestone 2? That is coming up very, very soon. I couldn't tell you the exact time, but it's like right on the verge of being in your possession. Hey, Croxy Satan, what is it? The Yodel Schnitzel? I'm not going to shout your name, but you have your little shout out. Do you have 10th anniversary T-shirts to show? I don't think we do. No, I think we've got Dawn of War 3 shirts.
Yeah, we got a Dao 3 shirt. We have the hoodies, which are amazing.
What we did get for the 10th anniversary was these custom made things from Relic. So yeah, we get these. They're like you can detach them and whatever.
Also,
and
I think
kind of engraved our names on them as well. I think if you can see, it says like General's Gentleman on the top there.
So we basically pillaged the office of like all the cool posters Like everything in the office, I was like, hey, Carl, can I have this? And he was like, no. Can I have this? Yeah, I suppose.
It's like, yeah, if it's not on the walls, take it. Yeah, I think. Is what he said.
So I have a really cool Co-1 poster, and I think you'll have the one which is like a kind of a concept art of like all these different squads, which was really nice.
Yeah.
So there's definitely some really cool stuff here at Relic. Like, there's so many prized little like posters they have. They have a lot of these little news clippings of talking about their games. You can really tell the passion that the guys at Relic have towards all of their projects.
Like the Warhammer collections. Oh,
the 40K,
incredible.
Yeah, there's so much stuff everywhere.
Everybody's like got these incredible Warhammer units. There's a lot of scope there. Like again, it's not something we can really discuss, but there looks like a lot of scope for future things there. When will you guys fly back? We fly back I fly back tomorrow. GG flies back.
I fly back on Monday, but I'm flying to America, and I'll be there for a couple of days, meeting up with a fellow Command & Conquer shoutcaster called Cybert, who I've known for quite a few years. So I'll be hanging out with him, doing some streams of some CNC games and such. Because of, like, if I'm all the way in Canada, I thought like I might as well take the opportunity to visit a friend of mine who, you know, I've known for a while, but obviously America's quite far away normally.
Lasorsison says, did you manage to use this trip to Relic to speak with Carl about the balance issue? I mean, there are no balance issues, so... shout out to Pontus for introducing me to the co-Frenchie in 2011. There we go. We've nearly got a game, by the way, but we'll do a couple more of these.
Careful, Stormless.
What's your opinion? Well, that's not really a relevant question. Are you playing the anthem of the winning side at the end? That is something we definitely could do. One thing that I didn't do, actually, was show you guys a little overview of the players today.
Oh, sweet.
So, yeah, I don't think we actually remembered to do this before. This is a little something that was drawn up by PigSoup.
A household name.
He's a household name. But again, like we've got this one here, actually, which shows you a little bit about the players and, of course, where we know them from. The other interesting one, and again, thank you so much, PigSoup, for doing this, was a little bit of stats information about these players. Of course, you've got major tournaments from DevM, SNF4, OCF, ESL. He got the EU number 9 win and the North America number 5. You know, he this is his progression through. The games that he lost were two games against Theodosius. Is that right? Games lost two, Theodosius two. Wouldn't that mean he was out of the tournament?
Maybe that was the qualifiers of the World Paint Championship, as well as then the actual tournament. Because he did play Theodosius twice. Do you want to just quickly check to see if the game hasn't already started? I feel like it may have done by now.
Yeah, that's cool. No worries. Alright, let's have a look through. Nope. Whoops. Wrong one. GG's throwing me off the bat there.
Yeah there is. Insane DevM. I know it seems to be a common occurrence with us, is you always get so carried away about these things, and I'm like, dude, we gotta actually cast the video games.
Well, that's equally you get carried off with some random comments, so we both do it.
Yeah,
like,
it's true. We're both guilty.
Just don't complain about it, it's just what happens, you know.
Don't hate, appreciate.
The game isn't going anywhere. Yeah, like, you know, we've got a 3-minute wait, and then we've got, you know, whatever, so we may as well flick over to stat screens.
So the same matchup as game number one, where we have DevM is the US and Jeslin is the OKW, and we kind of mentioned this earlier, like, this is actually really interesting because the faction selection doesn't matter, because I know Jeslin loves playing OKW, he actually would prefer OKW over anyone, yeah. And I think DevM is actually the same with US. Maybe he'd want to go Wehrmacht, but I'm pretty sure he would rather play US, and I believe he would have had a faction selection in this game as well, so I feel like in this series, the matchups aren't going to be particularly uneven, where you have some other series where both players really prioritize allies over the Axis.
Yeah, I think it is a matter as well of how you feel you perform with a faction, because you know, as we heard from like DevM yesterday, he strongly advocated actually not playing all five factions.
Yeah,
he firmly believes that by playing one of each allied or axis and playing it like extremely well, he thinks that is the best way for him, and he says regardless of the meta, then if you play a faction well enough and you know it like the back of your hand, you should be able to deal with all threats provided you spot them early enough. Whereas Jeslin is the other way around. Jeslin believes you should have a broad knowledge of the factions so you can exploit each one's weakness. So So it really is two different things there. And this is what the thing was, though, is Devem becomes predictable because of that.
Yeah.
Jezlyn is maybe slightly more unpredictable. And I think that's where we have a possible advantage. I need to update the scores very quickly.
I think it's a reflection of their playstyles overall. Devem is more about that crazy aggression, where Jezlyn is generally more about just having a very well-rounded army with a nice composition and playing for the late game, going for the VPs.
Yeah.
So we definitely do have a clash of different playstyles here, but here we are in game number 3 of the Warpaint Championship. We have our two finalists here, Devem and Jezlyn, the score being 1-1 so far. Devem now is going to be the US, and Jezlyn will be repping the Oberkommando West.
Yeah, and what a great couple of games it's been so far. Devem obviously won game 1 quite confidently with the US faction. And this is something, you know, Jezlyn did well. I have to say, like, he did well in game 1. It came down to VPs. That was really the main thing that explained that loss. A lot of the engagements actually seemed to go his way, though. So it was an interesting one. Now we have Kolodny Firma, which is a little bit of a different map. It's a bit more narrow. The Rakettans, I think, will do better here. There's less of that kind of open ground flanking that we saw on Angoville. These points are now a little bit more closed off. Even things like Tier 4 are going to be a little more effective in their positions of cover. So, do you think OKW maybe have a bit more of a chance here of being successful against USF? Is this the map for it?
Compared to Angoville, I don't know. I don't think either map is particularly favoriting either player in terms of which faction is going to be stronger. I feel like it's still going to be really hard for OKW in the early game to hold their fuel, the munitions, and the VP. They always had that early game struggle. This is perhaps not a good engagement here by DevM. He's going to lose a lot of riflemen. I guess he'll force away the Stern Pioneers. I guess he managed to muscle his way through that. But the Volks at the north... No, it's actually rather a Kubel, not going to be a squad of Volks. So there's only one Volks currently. He's actually moving in to the Rifleman. It's going to be Kubel there as well, perhaps to push around the Rifleman and get them out of cover.
Oh, this is a nice one, really, because they're also trying to force them out of the cover. They are going to try and take this house. Kubel's trying to push them off a little bit. He may actually keep doing that to stop the squad from getting to the door, but instead he's going to take a cover position and lose the house there. I think as we see here, Devem is going to come straight back up on that side. This is typical of Devem, really. He's going to put a lot of pressure on the right-hand side, trying to deny early fuel, and we'll see. Really, what Jezlyn does with it. He certainly wasn't able to hold the house there, which is a great start for Jezlyn.
I loved how Jezlyn sent the Kubel in first, because it meant that the Rifleman automatically turned to face the Kubel, so when the Volks charged in, they took no damage. So it was a really nice way of playing that, is use the Kubel or whatever light vehicle it is to soak up the shots, because you can repair that for free. Volks gonna be getting the house, the church even, away from the Rifleman, so this is actually a pretty good start here. We do have the south side being captured up by Devem, so he still has pretty even map control, but this is where you would normally see the US do pretty well. But I wonder what Jezlyn, or rather when he goes for his battle group, because it could be nice actually spamming a lot of Volks out before we get the battle group, so you have so much map control that you don't just fall behind. Once you lose the map on Kolodny, once you lose those key garrisons, the heavy cover gets wired off, it can be really hard to push back. Especially since, again, you don't have access to the flamers, you don't have the mortars as the OKW. The house will get taken here, but there's actually three squads and the Kubel, so this should be no problems. It should be very easy, rather, for Jezlyn to clear this out. And actually going for the cutoff as well with his Kubel. Can he actually hold it, though? It's going to be rifles charging up to the Kubel.
Yeah, I think he'll get this, to be honest. He's got way more than enough squads. Devem realizes this and has to retreat. This is a great OKW start, really, really is. He's got actually the territory he needs. Then he's actually adopted Devem's own strategy of just forgetting about the rest of the map and pushing in for the choke points, the cutoff points. He's preparing himself for another M20, another early game, and of course that is what's coming up straight away. Lieutenant's popped, M20 comes out straight away after that. Always a perfectly calculated build from DevM, but of course if it does chase the Koopa down through the center. You know, does DevM have an idea that this M20 could go down quickly?
Jezlin was actually building a Raketen, and then he cancelled it for his truck. That's actually a big mistake now. M20's coming out soon. Jezlin, he rebuilt the AT and then cancelled it. So he's really indecisive about this Raketen, and right now he really needs it. Unless the M20 hits the shoe mine.
Well, he can still afford the Raketen Werfer, so I don't really know what that decision is about. We could have both in effect.
Maybe he wants to go for a Puma. I don't understand why he wouldn't go for the...
I think he's probably banking everything he has on this M20 hitting that mine. I mean, this could be on the field for seconds, do you know what I mean? If it chases through the center in the right way.
I guess he wants Jaegers.
Well, also the Fausts. If he's going to tech up quickly, he may have access to Fausts. DevM isn't going to try it. I think DevM realizes that it's possible that OKW could have that tier up quick enough. I think the Faust is going to be very, very important. And also, DevM probably just clocked that mines are being laid there. So he's going to have to be careful. That was a little bit of a giveaway from Jezlin.
That's
going to...
And that other mine is on a very common spot. It's on the middle of the road, so it's pretty easy to avoid that. You always got to expect your opponent to mine those common mine spots. We have Jaegers being deployed here, but nice decaps with the Euro Echelon. They took out the strat point on the left side and then the cutoff as well here. So Jezlin actually losing his income, and this Koopa could go down here. He's near the Volks in the house, so scaring off the M20 for fear of Panzerfaust. Actually, we'll connect as well here.
There we go, nothing to finish this off at the moment, but it will make it difficult for the M20. What do you think about DevM never really popping the vehicle crew out of
this Volk squad? Negative cover was there for a while. That LT is pretty powerful with Thompson and that bar. The M20 may be able to cut him off and get the wipe there.
He's very, very lucky to get away with that.
What did you ask me, sir?
I was asking about the decision, of course. DevM never pops the vehicle crew out for the Zoom.
Oh, there go the Volks. I feel like Jezlin has suffered so much because he didn't go for the Raketen. If he had the Raketen, he may have been able to put the M20 in a place where it can't really do much, but the M20 has had so much impact, and that Volk squad was definitely a mistake. So the entire map now is in the hands of DevM. Jezlin only having a few squads on the field. He's going for the cutoff again. I feel like that was such a nice turnaround, how DevM, he had the counter cut off with the Echelon.
Yeah, he played that very, very well. It's actually a shame, you know, neither of the mine, the south, do you know what I mean, didn't go off. It was a bit of a shame. I'm not sure what he's doing here. He looks like he may be trying to get the Volks to go on the right retreat path. M20's not going to chase it that way, though.
Making a couple of Volks there on the retreat. Oh, it actually hits the mine.
It actually turns into it. Not expecting that. I thought it was going to follow the path.
That's kind of a shame now for Jezlin, because there's no squad there for a follow-up. If there was a Volk squad nearby, he could actually Faust that. What is he doing? He's going for the vehicle crew.
That was a very, very nice pop out there. That really, really was. I had to, it was a good job the Echelons were there.
Yeah.
Really, or even the Lieutenant, because that would have been absolutely catastrophic. That was really quick thinking from Jezlin. Now Jezlin's kind of returning the favour, though, to be honest. And he's actually starting to get his own way back against DevM.
He just needs to try and stall long enough to get the Osfin down. The Volk squad's getting pretty low. Actually throws a nade off here. But I don't think Jezlin can really afford to take those risks. Because he sees, if he loses one more squad, he's going to be out of this one. He's already one squad down. He's already got a fair bit of manpower bleed from that M20. DevM, I think he's actually teching up for his captain now. Looking at his lack of resources.
Double Jaeger light infantry here. I think this will be really good if DevM doesn't tech two bars again.
Yeah.
If he doesn't go for kind of upgrades, these units will pick things off. Especially when the veteran C starts coming in. This will be a very, very effective counters to just standard riflemen.
Jaegers also don't rely on munitions, so they have no upgrades. So what that means is you can spam a lot of mines down, and you can just throw a lot of the grenades too. So they're a good squad to have if you don't really have much map control, and therefore don't really have much income of munitions and fuel in particular. But Jezlin actually has recovered decently here. DevM though, he does have his captain, so he's not too far off getting his steward. In which case, Jezlin's probably going to need to have another Raketen now, only having one Raketen won't cut it.
little bit of bad move.
Oh, actually, there. The M20. I think he's out of the arc, though, of the Raketen. Actually, no, he evacs it. He can't, what is he?
He's doing the critical repairs, so he can.
No, but it was Echelon, it wasn't damaged. Oh, and there it goes! That was a weird maneuver there from DevM. There wasn't a damage engine, it was a Raketen shot, it wasn't a Panzerfaust.
No, I think that was a ground shot as well. I think because of the smoke, that wasn't an automatically acquired.
Yeah.
I think he took a shot through the smoke then manually. And what a payoff, what an absolute payoff now. DevM is without his kind of fabled, prized, medium, light vehicle on the field. So this presents a really good opportunity for Jezlin here. And I actually think, you know, the Ostwind strategy is going to be amazing.
Yeah, Jezlin isn't too far off the Ostwind, and with the M20 down, there is only the Stuart, and now, you know, maybe one Raketen can handle it. Maybe he'll actually get a Shrek on his Stern Pioneers, because he hasn't gone the sweeper yet. Is of course, he's versing US, so there isn't really a threat of mines apart from that M20. I don't know if there are any mines. I would say there's not, looking at the munitions count, but of course Jezlin doesn't know whether there's actually mines.
Jezlin's going to have to be forced to micro an engagement over here with the Kubla at the moment. He could probably take one bazooka and still get away from this, so it shouldn't be too much hassle. But again, you know, there have been some late retreats from Jezlin in this game. I've definitely noticed that he has had some lucky instances. How is he preparing himself, though, for the force that's going to push through the middle of the map now? Because he is being kind of soft decapped on the north, but he's just going to have to put up with Riflemen coming from the mid now. And there's no sign of an MG at the moment. And I think, you know, he obviously relies on the Ostwind for that kind of thing, but I think an MG would be great on this map, especially in this building. You know, we haven't seen DevM go for the mortar yet, so an MG would perform really well here.
MGs are vulnerable to tanks, though, and so if you're worried about the light vehicles pressuring you, then the MG can be risky. But as you say, the house in the left there, the church, that munitions house is what we're looking at now. There's a lot of really nice locations for the MG, but it is pretty risky in terms of getting wiped spot on retreat by a vehicle and of course being stolen by your opponent. So Jezlin, he's going to have a bit harder time now with the Stuart on the field, but only one command point off getting his Ostwind. I don't think he needs a second Raketen now at this stage, so that does open him up to just keep his manpower loaded up for the Ostwind. Kubla's still alive as well. The Kubla's just been driving around the map, getting some points capped. Overall, Jezlin's Kubla Micro, or rather the Kubla Preservation, has been pretty on point. We actually have nades tech here for DevM, and still no bars yet.
That was a really nice shot. Look at the dodges here. Jezlin's actually hopping out of buildings all over the shot to dodge grenades. One shot from the Raketen lands on the Stuart. Stuart's going to have to back out of this, making it a failed push on this side of the map. And now it's going to leave Jezlin to just get some extra pickups on these riflemen. And of course, these are really, really important. At the moment, Jezlin is actually trailing DevM in kind of pop cap. It's starting to go his way, his favor. So I think this is... this is really important because we saw it in game one.
Oh no! Just as
we
were talking nicely about Jezlin's grenade dodges there, the house was quite low because I think there was a couple of nades that hit it earlier. So the grenade there from DevM actually gets the killing blow on the Volk squad. So we only have one squad of Volks and three Jaegers, so there isn't going to be many Panzerfausts, which could leave Jezlin a little bit vulnerable to the M10s down the line. There's a lot of those on the field.
Yeah, this is really unfortunate as well, because the Volks are really needed here, and now he's down to three Jaeger Light Infantry, which he's been using for the decap. But the composition of this... Oh no! I did not expect that to go that way. I left that because I thought there's four of them. They're not going to die, but Jesus, there goes the...
The Stuart's very powerful, but it could be a squad wipe in return. Stim Pioneers and the Ostwind can take the squad down pretty effectively here, and there shouldn't really be anything to prevent this Ostwind from just chasing the riflemen down across the entire map, unless the Stuart shows up with a stun round or something. There's a captain there with a bazooka, but nothing to worry too much. Oh, wow!
What?
Jezlin doesn't commit to that, but he has to be careful about the Stuart. I still think it would have been worth it, but maybe he was worried about there being, say, an M1 AT gun. Bad luck there from Jezlin. Like, you think he would have wiped by there. And actually, two AT grenades connect from two rifle squads.
Yeah, that was really unfortunate. The right thing to do, but just no payoff, unfortunately.
Well, looking at the pop cap, it's actually pretty much even. But I think that's because the Stewart's been evacuated, so that should go back in DevM's favour shortly. Other than that, the map patrol is kind of even, but the VPs are definitely now ahead for DevM, who has had a triple cap for a bit of a while, actually, recently at least. So DevM is putting the pressure on, and I'm curious about his commander and his teching. At this rate, I actually expect to see the Pershing. I think he would have gone the M10 by now if he was going to go for the M10s.
I don't know, I think he will probably play kind of the standard faction until the commander is required. And I don't think that situation has come up because these start of like engagements have started going his way. I don't think he really feels like he needs to pick one. You know, as he gets later and later into the game, you know, it could ease into a number of things, really. And you know, I think he could end up seeing a Pershing if he gets late enough into the game. You know, and he doesn't want to tech up to his major. Good option for him there. I think he does favour that off map, though. I think he really favours that off map considering.
Yeah, but it's just because with the offspin on the field, what is DevM's counter to that? He has, again, the Steward and the Bazooka, that's not going to cut it, so maybe he'll have to go for an AT gun if he doesn't want to go for the M10, which I think is actually probably the best thing to do, because I feel like the Pershing will be much better in the late game. Does go for the M10, in fact, so wants to have that counter to the Osfin, because he is starting to lose territory and possibly lose some squads. But currently, the unit preservation has been on point for DevM. He has three rifles, the Lieutenant, and the Captain. So just needs to get some bars on those squads, really, a bit better scaling against the Jaegers.
Lieutenant squad here in a little bit of trouble. A couple of models on the negative cover there. Shoemaker needs to be so careful. Lands within the vision of the Rickett and hasn't made it out yet. That's a lovely second shot. The Faust does go off. Will it connect? Yes, it does. Stuart is down.
Actually, even then, look, the Stern Pioneers were planting a mine, but here we go. The M10 chasing after the Ostfin. The Rickett is actually refacing here. We have a sort of Volts getting wiped. Jezlin running out of stuff here. The Ostfin may go down. Not enough veterancy for the combat bullet. And the Captain's moving in as well here. The Ostfin goes down to the M10. Kupel may do so after as well here.
Yeah, but that was a real shame, because the Rickett was lined up to kind of push the M10 away. But it was a really good, kind of like a well-informed push from DevM. Like, whilst he was doing that, units rushing up, just detected everything that was going to counter that. So a really good play there.
The problem was, as I mentioned earlier, is Jezlin just lost all his Volks, and he just didn't have enough squads for Panzerfaust. If he had three Volks still alive, he could have had some Volks nearby to prevent the M10s from being so aggressive against the Ostfins. The Captain gonna barely survive that one, still Pioneers at long range aren't too powerful. So yeah, this game is looking pretty one-sided now, but I suppose Jezlin still has been putting up a pretty fair fight. I do like how Jezlin has gone for the Volks rather than a third squad of Jaegers, because he really does need to have more Panzerfausts.
I wouldn't say by any means that Jezlin has played bad. I mean, the start of this game was all Jezlin. But this is a huge mistake here. Like, where is the support for this? Like, he's going to be disappointed with this, I can tell you, because this is a mistake. And why was the Ostwin far away?
Oh, wow.
Now, he may even just throw the towel in now, because that is a huge, huge loss for no reason whatsoever. You know, the counters haven't really come on yet. How quick is DevM's micro?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? To spot those grenades, and he gets the throwback!
Nice.
Incredible micro from DevM. And that's really why people struggle to play against DevM, is the speed of his reactions is more of that than mere humans.
Yeah. Jezlin, he's played so well, but he just made some crucial mistakes there. He lost, I think the first Volk squad was because he wasn't watching it, and it just got absolutely melted by the Lieutenant with the bar and the Thompson up close. Secondly, there wasn't a grenade dodge from that house, so it really, he's made two pretty big mistakes, which have put him behind in more ways than he can recover from. because it resulted in the M10 just having free reign. I love how DevM crushes the Rex. Don't know if it was intentional or not, but it denies the salvage. Something that actually Jezelin hasn't been doing, hasn't been salvaging.
There's the abandon.
Yeah, wow.
The RNG wheel has spoken. There are a lot of Kugel abandons, to be honest.
Could be a second Raketen, but DevM can probably just run all over Jezelin's infantry to get the bars. But yeah, going for nades instead. This is actually a pretty normal trait of DevM. He goes for nades rather than bars. I don't know why that is actually. Because also considering grenades, they cost more fuel than weapon racks. I mean, grenades are great, I'm just saying, I don't know why he doesn't have bars as well as grenades. Considering he already has the M10, you know, the Osfins have already been dealt with. You think he'd want to focus now on just having the best infantry that he can.
Well, where does Jezelin go from here, really? I mean, he's probably going to flick out for another Ostwind, surely. Relying on two Raketens to give the AT. But he's going to struggle, you know. We have the USF Mortar now. We didn't have that on the field too far before. So, you know, the Raketens aren't necessarily going to have stable positions once they fire. They're going to come under Mortar fire. I just don't know if they're going to manage this. But I think DevM's really clocked onto Jezelin's floor here, which was that triple Jaeger infantry build. Like, yeah, there's just no snares, and he's just free to roam. There's really, like, so little for him to worry about now. And it kind of allows him to be hyper-aggressive.
The
Which
build
exactly
was fine, he just lost all his squads, Volts.
Yeah.
You know, if he had three Jaegers and three Volts, that would have been insanely powerful. That would have been very difficult for rifle squads to deal with it, especially without bars. But Company of Heroes is a game about unit preservation, and when DevM has flawless preservation of his infantry, he lost both his vehicles, but that's bound to happen eventually. But losing none of his infantry squads, Jezelin losing a few. Stun grenade actually from the Stern Pioneers.
DevM was not stunned. Not stunned at all.
Yeah, I think the Stern Pioneer grenades work differently to the Elite Troops grenades, which actually do prevent retreats.
Dangerous. Dangerous. I mean, now that DevM knows that the AT is on a kind of retreat, the M10 just has complete freedom to do what it wants. It's a very difficult situation for Jezelin.
But at least this is a best of five, so we do have more games to come, even despite the fact that this will be 2-1 in favour of DevM. And the Ostwind has been called in now, the third Ostwind. With two Raketens, he can probably keep this alive as long as the Ostwind doesn't get caught too out of position.
Oh, the Stern Pioneers are doing a lot of work, 16 kills in the moment.
Yeah, it's probably more than these Jaegers have.
Yeah.
And we have the M4A3 Sherman, so actually I do like how Jezelin is teching, even if it isn't the best choice, which I guess it probably is, but it's nice to see him teching, you know, because we used to play as just not teching, even when they had the opportunity to do so. I feel like then it does set you up well for the late game, because say even if somehow Jezelin pulls out a King Tiger, then you already have access to the Jackson, which is kind of what you really want to have against the King Tiger. The M10s can die pretty easily, get two-shotted by the King Tiger. But it's going to be finally, I think the middle VP captured back by Jezelin here. He's down at 130. DevM maintaining his triple cap for quite a while now.
Sherman as well has just arrived on the field. A little bit of extra threats here. This is a bit dangerous for the Raketens, I feel, as well. So we get around the back of the Raketens of high explosives. That could be quite bad. Look at the range of that grenade. That was an amazing
throw.
Yeah,
it's because they're bet 3. They get extra grenade range as they bet up. But that was actually a lot of range. Okay, there's the M4A3 Sherman. Has the HG rounds equipped. Gonna take a couple of shots from the Raketen. The M10's flanking the Ostwind here. Where are the snares, Stormless? There's no Panzerfaust left. The Ostwind completely surrounded now. Still the HG ammo, but it won't matter if the Sherman is flanking in the rear armor. And even the Raketen's being circled here. Actually, they're also doing some pretty good damage to the Sherman. The Raketen does brushes. Get taken out. So many squads of riflemen. Ostwind's trying to push them around, and there's the abandon. Oh man, this RNG wheel was a terrible idea, wasn't it?
The RNG wheel has spoken, and we have the abandon. I think he's going to be upset about that, if I'm honest.
I mean, we can talk all we want about balance, we can talk all we want about RNG, but Jezalen lost three squads very early on.
And that was definitely came down to outside the RNG realm. That was a shame, because like the early game was so good, like that strong rush with the Kubel for this base, like, you know, where did he let that go? What happened to that great map control, you know? How do you go from pinning DevM in his base to losing all map territories?
Just inattentiveness. I don't think Jezalen has as good multitasking as DevM does. Yeah, DevM was dodging grenades all over the place, as we saw. Jezalen, not so much, and he got a little bit flustered. I mean, DevM gets late retreats, but at least he does retreat them late rather than just letting them die or not dodging them. But yeah, it's a shame. It's a shame, because I think this could have been a really interesting match, because it was very close. And even I would say that Jezalen was outplaying DevM for the most part. But when you lose that many squads, it's a bit more punishing for Axis in particular, but even as allies. If you lose three squads of Riflemen, what do you expect is going to happen?
Well, three allied wins, though.
Yeah, I know. I know. I know that the chat's not happy, but, yeah.
Just seen DevM walking around out there. Yeah.
Maybe he's like, man, I need more pizza. I need to
I think he's gone for another coffee. Yeah, I think he's realized the benefit of that coffee and just how much his performance improved after drinking.
Yogis Ape asked, which one of you is taller? Definitely me, considerably.
I'm not going to.
Shall we?
No.
No? You don't want to?
don't give in.
Don't even.
Please.
I guess, like, the way we're sitting, you actually look taller probably because you're close to the webcam.
They want to see the rifle, actually. Well, we'll have a
little
bit of time.
Do you want to be a rifle blob? Let's be a rifle blob.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Let's get these chairs to the side, actually. I think you just pop those over with the RNG wheel. And then people can see the lovely...
Here you go, sir. There is your rifle. Rifles ready!
Yeah! They're just carrying these things around at Relic. It's a replica. It's not actually... it's not actually, you know, fireable or anything like that.
Yeah, they're quite painted black as well. There's no color on it.
Yeah, it's incredibly heavy, though. And I think these are, as they were saying, like, with some props or something. Is that right? Or at least when we spoke yesterday, they were giving
people...
It was for
the live action trailer they did.
Right, right.
You know how they made that trailer for Ardent's Assault, I think?
Yep. But, oh, sorry, I was going to say, pop that one back. I'll put it on the floor.
Please buff MP40.
So, yeah. See, there's a lot of interesting stuff, actually. And there's also, they've got, like, a Vickers gun in the other room as well. With some sandbags and things.
Oh,
we were just
amazing.
On the Vickers gun. You guys can head over to our Twitters as well and have a look. There's some pictures of us on the Vickers gun, which is really cool.
It's so heavy, because, again, it's weighted. Mm. You don't really realise how heavy these weapons actually are. You know, it's... You'd have to be really tough to carry them around. And that's why they, it's their third game. They distribute it. Because the Vickers is on a tripod, where I'm pretty sure one of the crew would carry the tripod, the other one would carry the gun, and the other one would carry the ammo and such.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, in Code 2, they just pick up the entire tripod with, like, one guy on his own, and it's like, yeah, okay, sure.
Von Lietzo, yeah, obviously it's a replica, dude.
it's not a real M1 Garand.
Can you imagine? It'd be a different programming studio. I think we'd have to keep those away from DevM and Jezalen.
Yeah.
Yep.
It would be cool if it was the same, like, colours, though, but I don't know if it's, like, a legal thing, like, if you need to have replicas painted dull. Because if you were to walk into a store with that M1 Garand, it's pretty obvious it's fake, because it's just black, whereas if it was coloured, it would look real, and it could probably be might require some kind of, like, license. I mean, I don't know about, obviously, there's legal stuff here in Canada, but you probably need to have a license to have an actual gun, or at least something that looks
like an actual
license.
Gun. You need a special license to have a concealed only, like, light firearm.
But, like, I'm talking about even if it's a replica, that looks real. You need a license for a replica gun.
I just
gun.
Wouldn't walk around with one of those. It's not only is it completely pointless.
Yeah.
Right, so... anticipation of game two. Well, it's not game two. It's game two on Claude Nufarma. It's obviously game four, but I need to do the scores, actually.
I really want to see Devin win this, just because I want all the people whining in chat to see Axis do well. And I feel like every game we've always had our Axis players just make so many mistakes that it's been a pretty big factor, more so than I think the issues that we do have with balance. But yeah, we got Jezlin as the Soviets now. He's going to have the tank hunter tactics, actually, as well as partisans as well.
This we've wanted to see tank hunter tactics.
Yes, finally.
Because a lot of people will say, oh my god, tank hunter tactics, and laugh. But we've seen Jezlin play tank hunter tactics at an incredible level. And the last time we saw it, he was pinning down... Do you remember? He was pinning down some random player in 1v1. Like, in his base with just PTRS cons. And it was absolutely, like... beautiful to see, and I think you missed it. I think you actually dropped out of the game before it happened. But he used the PTAB bombing run to just wipe everything.
Oh, that's really strong
on a retreat path. It got everything. So like, it's a really cool. It's a little like it's a gimmick move, obviously, to finish a game. But that would be very interesting to see. But will he use it? You know, he has to win this game. He absolutely has to win this game to stay in. So we're probably going to see a meta use again.
And it's indicative of penal spam. There is every single commander in Jezlin's loadout is going to completely complement penals, because he's going to have the guards, or he'll have the tank hunter partisans, or he'll have the PTRS cons. So it does give him a very strong use of penals, especially when you have a map with so many garrisons, so many heavy cover locations as well. So you do have a lot of powerful flamer use. But here we are in game number four of the Warpaint Championship Grand Final. It's been about, I think, 2 months to get here, the road for our players and for the casters. It's been a lot of fun, and this could perhaps be the last game. It is a match point for DevM. He is 2-1 in this series. It is the best of five. So Jezlin, as the Soviets, has to play this one flawlessly to keep the Spanish dream alive.
And we get a nice opportunity to look at this build again, because of course we saw in that game number two that the MG and the Grenadier comes out before the Penal Battalion gets on the field. And you can see the timing of this. It gives DevM a really nice opportunity to get set up in a way that he wants. And of course, Oster is all about positioning. So he has a really good opportunity right now to go over to this northern side of the map, get the MG in the building, you know, get all of his units in the right places, and wait for the penal battalions. Of course, this didn't stop Jezlin in the previous game, though. The penal battalions were very strong when complemented by the guards, and it's probably something that we're going to see again. However, no players are jumping in with the commander, which is good. They're still leaving strategy open in case they need to make any changes to deal with their opponents. So it's good. It's open-ended at the moment. Same builds, though, for both players. We're probably going to expect to see the sniper. I think it came quite late. I think the sniper was like 5 or 6 minutes previously.
Yeah, it was a bit late. I think the sniper... I did say in game one that it's a bit harder... Or rather, it's a bit better against penals, but this is a really hard map for the sniper. So I wonder if DevM will delay the sniper in favor of getting 3 or 4 Grens and then sniper. I know he'll still get it either way, but maybe he'll get it later, given that it is a bit harder to use it on this map.
This, by the way, is a classic DevM tactic that he was actually talking himself about earlier. So what he's done is he uses the MG at the start of the game at a forward position. He's then going to run that MG to another position on the map to deceive his opponent into thinking he's gone double MGs. And that's exactly what he's doing. He was saying it earlier. He's like, I'm going to take an MG, I'm going to suppress a unit, and then I'm going to run it somewhere else, and it's going to be, you know, it's going to look like I have more than I have. This time, though, he's actually calling
bluff. DevM is adapting!
He's actually playing a strategy that we're not familiar with. Oh my god. And I mean, MG play, though, is doing really good.
I like that he isn't going sniper, given that Jezlin is going for M3 and he perhaps knows Jezlin's strategy.
Yeah.
However, MG isn't actually that good against the M3, though. You're very vulnerable to the clown car, where you have the flamer inside of the M3 if you leave the MG in a house. That being said, though, it's going to give DevM insanely powerful cutoff potential, which currently is actually taken. Jezlin is disconnected from his points, and with two MGs, it could be hard to actually flush out. But he is vulnerable to the clown car here. Maybe he should have gone for another squad of grenadiers, so you have plenty of Panzerfaust. The Pina's going to do pretty good damage here to the MG. MG, I think, is looking for the church. Really wants to be. No munitions there for Faust.
No, it looks like Jeslin was a little bit scared of it, though. He backed away as if, you know, if it's going to happen.
He almost lost the house there. Actually, Jeslin's munitions, he could actually satchel this. It might be worth it, considering that there's two MGs. But maybe not. He wants to have the flamers instead. But that could be an option. The quick satchels can be quite... Oh, no! The partisans! That's going to be the partisan spawn getting the wipe on the MG. Probably the steal as well here. Oh, man. Actually, the MG is going to be set up on the retreat path, so maybe he'll lose the partisans or the MG. We'll have to see. Let's look at the MG. Is it retreating? Yeah, retreating through the MG42.
I think he'll get away with that. Oh, man. I really do think he'll get away with that. Devin may... I mean, he can't pop any... We can't pop a rifle from there, but again, the squad is so spread out on the retreat, it's just not going to happen. That's a really nice steal for Jeslin.
Yeah, it was nice timing there. It's a little bit sad. I mean, the reason why I don't like being able to spawn out of houses is because it takes no preparation or foresight. You just click a button and you get a free wipe on an MG. So it wasn't really Dev M making a mistake. He didn't really do anything wrong. But Jeslin did capitalize on it. He did commit himself to this commander, which isn't the best commander in terms of late game. Maybe it won't be worth it here, but probably will.
The other interesting thing as well is that, I mean, the partisan selection, perhaps this has been selected with the kind of suggestion that the sniper would be on the field. Maybe that's what, you know, partisans was initially kind of being kept in mind for, but Devin hasn't taken that decision this game. So whilst it is going to perform very well against the support units, look at this, look at these preparations here from Dev M.
Perhaps Dev M, yeah, should have put some wire down. You can wire off one of the doors. Yeah. So then you force the partisans to spawn from the rear door, in which case they won't be able to get a wipe on a retreat. So that's kind of, you can prepare for that if you know it's coming by putting wire down or S-mines as we see now. But before you see it, there isn't really much you can do about it. So that's actually the same squad of partisans, I believe.
That was some great pathing there. The scout car, even with all this time to make a decision, still drove into the tree. Absolutely phenomenal.
Other than that, what do we have? We've got four grenadiers here. So actually a very Gren heavy build for Dev M, more so than what we normally see. Jeslin has a lot of munitions, manpower as well here, so he's going to be going for the penals. Again, he doesn't have the guards, the really strong squad that he wants to have right now, but he will have an MG to his name. This retreat path should be fine there. I think his friends are nearby, actually. Oh, they're suppressed. So, still, I mean, it doesn't even matter if he's suppressed, you can still fire the Faust off, so the M3 can't fully commit to chasing down the MG.
It's nice he's putting a little bit of pressure right now on the strategic cutoffs, and this time though he doesn't have guards, and I think, you know, if Dev M can get scout cars out here at the moment, I mean, he's only got to worry about the anti-tank partisans, which are actually very, very good, to be honest, but scout cars can still perform well enough, you know, they do have more opportunities to retreat, they're not getting buttoned. I think that's a really important thing, is not getting buttoned, necessarily.
VP is pretty much even for both of our players here. Jeslin is playing pretty well here in terms of the fuel's being disconnected. It's really important to try and delay Dev M because then it'll force him to go for mobile defense if he doesn't have enough on the field to counter the T-70. T-70 is a little bit delayed, of course, because of the M3 and the 2-2-2 now showing up. So that's going to be a nice counter to the M3.
Guys, the scout car we're talking about. I mean, the partisan anti-tank hunters could kind of mop this up quite nicely. Devon's probably a little more careful than that, to be honest. He's probably going to make sure that he either owns the buildings where this is going to come out, or have some other kind of protection in place. I mean, this kind of thing is risky, though. These could pop out at any time. Does he have the 18 AIDS text as well? Should probably check that out.
Yeah, it's really important to have those grenades preemptively teched, So then you can spawn out if you need to and get the insta nade with the insta shred. It's a pretty crazy combination. We actually had it. I think he spawned it, but he didn't get the nade off. Yeah, see, big mistake from Jezalem. He didn't have the nade tech. So he spawned the Tank Hunter partisans, I think at the north of the position, which was on screen. But he spawned the Shreks, and he actually got one Shrek off, but that's not it. Not enough for the kill. And then after that, they're not a very good squad. They're very fragile. So if you don't get the initial wipe with them when you spawn them, they can fall off pretty damn hard. I don't think there's a med bunker though for Venom. He's really going to be suffering from that, especially against Flamers. Do you want to look at his base quickly, see what if he has a med bunker? Oh, he does. Okay, good. Very crucial timing as well. We see all his green squads retreating it with not much health.
Difficult one. Difficult one for Devim to get out of with his current build, because it's so infantry focused that it surely has some pretty, you know, easy counters at the moment, and especially with the stolen MG as well, which is a six-man squad. It's defended by PPSH partisans. Yeah. This is, if you're going to recrew an MG, like, recrew it with the partisans, because you have a very, very strong squad there, regardless of the actual support weapon as well.
The thing is with the partisans though, as you say, the damage is really strong, but I'm pretty sure the squad is so easy to kill. The received accuracy is very low, so it's kind of a trade-off that you have. You do have really good damage, but then the squad not very durable here. I think the game is still actually pretty even, apart from the map control, that can change very quickly. I feel like actually the composition is better for DevM now, just because he has a lot of Grens which scale very well. I mean, there's three Penals which will scale better, but you kind of have critical mass of LMG Grenadiers where you can just burst down squads at long range with those LMGs. But DevM has to be careful about the T-70, which shouldn't be too far off here. DevM was considering building a pack. He does have the scout card here, so he has some kind of anti-tank, and this M3 going, getting for a bit of a bait, but the Shrek not actually firing there. That would have put the wipe on the 2-2 if that connected.
That was very unfortunate. That was really, like, just in range as well. And, unfortunately, maybe being on attack move, that may have actually got the shot off.
Yeah.
But it didn't look like that was the case.
Well, I saw the Shrek was raised to fire, but it wasn't in range for long enough. DevM, going for his sniper now, I like that, but I fear it may be too early, because I think Jezalem actually has his tier 3. A T-70 right now could just actually wreck face, because there's only that 2-2-2 needs to have a pack out on the field. Or, I mean, I could say maybe Shreks, but there's not enough munitions for that, and with four Grens, you really want to spend all that munitions on the LMGs. But the sniper's going to be really good against the Penals, because the Penals outscale the LMG Grens. You want to have something to whittle them down.
Yeah. But the other thing as well is, of course, as we just heard through Radio Intercept, Jezalem knows that that sniper's just come on the field, so he's going to get that extra burst of it. Like, he knows that Devim doesn't have an AT gun. If Jezalem's been listening to Radio Intercept, which is this ability from the partisans, if you didn't know, he will know the exact build of Devim's army right now. So he's going to be able to play a very, very informed game here at the moment. He's going to be able to keep rolling with the counters constantly. This Penal Battalion is going to be a very, very strong push here.
Especially when you have a map with so many garrisons, the sniper's really hard to keep alive, because the partisans can always spawn and wipe them. There's a lot of those smaller houses that you don't actually use, but you can spawn from them. For example, to the top left of that main house there with the scout car, you can spawn from that. So you do have to be very careful. Maybe we should see DevM wire off some of those doorways, or mine them with the S mines, just to try and prevent the partisans from being that powerful. They also have to... Oh man, the mine detonates from the partisans. He actually may wipe the Grenadier squad if he's following that one up, but DevM's multitasking is generally too good for this to happen. Yeah. The fact that they can also throw the guard grenades is really, really strong, but those grenades are crazy powerful. We actually have a squad getting hunted down by the M3 near the south munitions point, if we don't have a flick over there. Okay, oh wow, that's actually very low. I thought I had a squad inside of it, could have actually chased it down and wiped it. So, I think Jezalem's going for a tier 4. The enemy has
has broken our supply lines.
Yeah, tier 4 is actually up. And the 85, is that an 85 or a 76 actually?
Well, there's only 76.
Oh yeah, sorry. There's no, yeah.
No, so when you're so used to guard mode,
yeah, right.
Being
what's
better.
This unit? Like, what is this? Is this what I think it is? Yeah, so it's nice. It's a nice rush actually. That's going to be a really dominant unit actually. The 76 is going to perform very, very well here against this combination. Still no AT, but I'm happy. I have a guess that later on when Devem does get some munitions again, he'll probably be using the Panzer Shreks.
I feel like you're better off not being behind heavy cover, because when you're behind heavy cover against a flamer, you clump up and then you take a lot of damage, where if you're out in the open, you're more spread out. So you're not always better off, because then obviously the rifles will do more damage, but a lot of the times against flamer squads, you're better off actually just staying in the open. Oh, there goes the 2-2-2, I think that was the AP ammo from the MG. Inflicting losses upon us. And now the M3 is still alive. Yeah, it was the AP ammo, you just checked. So nice little preemptive pop there of the ability.
Yeah, I mean, that again, that's another really important little victory there. And you know, the scout car wasn't initially there. The scout car had come in from that direction. But already having the AP switched, he's given him the best possible result from that engagement he could have asked for. To be very careful here, because if he loses another model, oh no, it hasn't got the veterancy yet, so he can't actually use the incendiary ability.
Okay, so Devem goes for his mechanized, he goes for his Stuki, so he will have the target in the late game, so he's in a much better spot than if he went for the Puma. So I like how he went for the Stuki. I don't know if it was completely necessary, maybe to go on for a pack or some Shreks, but still, having the Stuki is going to be great. It won't deal with the T-34, but it will kind of deal with the penals in particular, and it's durable enough that the Tank Hunter Partisan Shreks aren't really a concern on their own.
Dangerous for the sniper here, though. Negative cover.
Oh,
Scout goes in. That was predictable.
Negative cover, and it was a vet too, so I had extra accuracy on that M3. That was crazy.
Yeah, this is really, really good. And another 76 is actually coming up as well. So again, this is going to start becoming very, very difficult for. It's going to start being very, very difficult for Devem to handle, especially with the 76 as well.
It's
its rear armor facing. There's nothing to snare it here. Panzer Grenadiers won't be able to do anything. The Stug is forced to retreat. Jezelin doesn't know whether he's going backwards or forwards there. Could have blocked the unit in. Actually, probably let that escape. But another shot could penetrate and destroy this unit. He's going to force the rear armor shot anyway. Misses because he's driving the tank. He needs to focus, sit the unit still.
Faust! Why is he Fausting?
Well, I don't know. He hasn't got the munitions.
I was looking at the wrong player. I was looking at Jezelin's munitions flow. Yeah, he doesn't have the munitions for it. So he actually lost his Stug E there. Yeah, I think not having that pack was greedy. That's the problem here. Is the M3, there's two T-34s, and he doesn't have a pack. He has no AT. Yeah. The Stug E on their own, even if you don't flick, you can't really kill them. Oh, what?! That the world's worst garrison, the P-Grens go down. Oh my god, this game is crumbling all of a sudden. 33 pop cap to the, I think, the 60 of Devem.
Yeah, Jezelin suddenly picked up into a beast form here. It's things are just starting to roll. Jezelin's kind of lost, Devem's kind of lost face a little bit. And, again, like, to lose the Panzer Grenadiers like that, I mean, finally we have an AT gun, we finally have this that's coming onto the field, but it's just going to get overrun.
Yeah, that was brutal. I mean, you should never be in that house there. That wooden house there, there's a few like it as well. Those wooden houses just aren't good. They're so weak. They're there really just for cosmetics. I don't even know why he was in there in the first place.
I think he was trying to stop getting crushed.
Yeah.
I think that was the main thing, is he'd identified there were a lot of units there. And he didn't want the crush. But that clearly didn't work out well for him.
So I think what happened there is Devem actually had the Panzer Shreks being upgraded. Oh yeah, that's why. He had Panzer Shreks. So, but what he perhaps should have done is actually cancelled the Panzer Shreks. Because he would have had three Panzerfausts that would have all connected. That would have done a bit less than half the health of the T-34. But he was just waiting for the Shreks. So it was a bit of a timing there where Devem didn't have any Shreks. didn't have any pack. It was vulnerable to the T-34s. And that sniper should have been a pack. He needed the pack before he went sniper.
I have a couple of issues here with Jezelin's current build. He doesn't need this third 76. He could have a Katusha. The Katusha would be great. The other thing as well is that why is he not going for the triple cap right now? Like, easily this unit needs to be going down there, but instead he's focusing on trying to beat DevM out with micro engagements. And this is, in my opinion, one of the worst things you can do, because DevM will beat you in micro engagements. His advantage right now is being able to take the TPs down, and he's in severe danger of losing this.
Trying to circle this pack. Yeah, it goes down. T-34 gets the killing blow there. Let's see if actually the penals go down. He re-crews the pack, and that's going to be... Oh, the Grens are retreating. No, so the penal went down?
Yeah.
Yeah, he lost the penals, but let's see how many Grens go down as well.
Not focused about the Gren wipes, actually. Although when the AT gun goes down, he's going to be able to recap that for himself. And he could probably get away with a base rush here, to be honest. There's nothing now that is going to be able to stop this. I wouldn't be surprised if the 76s do rush in. Jezelin is going for the triple cap, finally, which is a sensible idea.
This composition for Jezelin isn't good. He only has two squads of scaling infantry. He has two penals, where Devim has four Grens, which are all Vet 2, one of them is Vet 3, so if Devim actually holds on here, he has so many VPs left, just needs to get a little bit more fuel out, and obviously get a pack, because there's 3 T-34s.
I really think too, have you noticed like Jezelin's been using the spy network as well?
Yeah.
So this I think is actually one of the things, is that his decisions...
Oh wow, this is a big mistake here, he shouldn't be pushing out like this. There's zero AT, he's going to lose his vetted Grenadiers, or at least lose a lot of manpower, and he needs to get a pack out. With how much VPs DevM has, he has 350. He needs to just stay in his base, get a pack out. Again, he's still probably going to lose this game because of how many T-34s there are. But I feel like he shouldn't be trying to push out when he has completely no AT at all.
DevM surrenders.
Yeah. That game wasn't going anywhere good. I mean, I thought maybe he had a chance there because there wasn't any late game scaling for Jezelin. He had no infantry that scaled well. He had two squads that didn't scale well. He didn't have a good late game commander. But of course, Jezelin closing that game out with the T-34s. So that was probably the closest game we've had yet. I felt like because the early game was played flawlessly, really for both of our players. There wasn't any crucial mistakes. There wasn't any squad wipes. Nobody lost anything to dumb stuff. So we had a pretty close game. But it got a little bit out of hand there towards the end. We saw the P-Grens went down. We saw the sniper went down. It was really good preservation of the M3. And he actually was managed to make it relevant in the late game. The partisans, the wipe on the MG and the steel was really important, but at the same time, I feel like it wasn't actually that effective in the long run, because the partisans didn't really do much. The tank hunter partisans, they didn't wipe the 222. So the tank hunter partisan, they were pretty much a dead weight. They didn't do anything the entire game.
No.
The commander late game kind of sucks. It's just because Jezelin had so much of a fuel lead. He was able to just spam those T-34s, and DevM, he didn't get any AT. He went for the sniper instead of the pack. He didn't have Shreks, he didn't have a pack, he had nothing. And so obviously, the moment the T-34s showed up, they just kind of wrecked face, more than I thought they would, but even then, you can't leave yourself without having any AT solutions.
Yeah, it was a shame. I actually feel like, he could have closed that game out so much earlier if he had the 18 aids selected.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, you know, the scout car was... the scout car could have gone down much earlier. And again, you know, like, we didn't see the sniper. And the sniper is one of those things that really does kind of eat away. I kind of felt like without the sniper being there early, the Grens weren't doing enough manpower hits on the Soviets. And the Soviets just kind of built, you know what I mean? It was effective enough for him to just spawn the partisans constantly. And he always had enough manpower to kind of just get away with that. And I think a sniper can actually reduce your ability, do you know what I mean?
So you're talking about the Soviet sniper?
No, I'm talking about Oster sniper. Okay. Yeah. So I think, like, Devim always says, like, that's a key part of the...
Yeah. But he couldn't get it because of the M3, and because of also the fact that Kolodny, there's just so many shot blockers, it's really easy to get ambushed. As we saw in that game, you know, all of a sudden, the negative cover, the M3 ambush, it's very hard to use the sniper. Mm-hmm. And I actually really liked how he delayed it, because he had a really good early game, he was very aggressive with it, with a double MG. I mean, obviously lost one, but the Partisans was a pretty big investment. I think his early game was fine. I loved how he got the sniper late. I think the sniper was good. It was too soon, even though it was late, because he didn't have any AT. If he had a pack out, if he had the Shreks out, and then he went the sniper, he would have been in a much better spot, I think.
Yeah. What have we got? More crybaby.
Are we having another break? I think there's pizza and there's people eating.
Oh, they're out there, aren't they? I can see them.
Yeah. Carl bought like way too much pizza, so yeah, we kind of need to devour it. Otherwise, it's going to go to waste.
Well, I think the kind of agreement that we had was that the players would take breaks every two games. So, you know, they're going to be able to just have a little bit of a breather. The last break was actually really interesting because Devem's there, he's brewing his coffee, he's like, quick, get in my veins.
Yeah.
We're just cramming down some pizza. And then, like, Jeslin had a Kinder Bueno. He had this Kinder Bueno bar. He's just eating the chocolate. He's got his headphones in, probably listening to a Shadow Wada podcast on micro intensity and how to win esports. And it's working for him, do you know what I mean? He's doing well, but Jeslin is centering himself, like, quite intensely at the moment. And who would have thought, really, that it comes down to this, like, the fifth game? I don't think anybody was expecting it to be a game five.
Absolutely. Jeslin is putting on an absolute show. And for game number five, I honestly don't know what to expect here. My prediction, you asked me, I don't know if it was on stream or not, but I thought it was going to be 3-1. Mm. And it's 2-2 now. So this is actually proving to be a very close grand final. Yeah, it's been pretty fun. I'm hoping we have a bit more even game. I think that last game was definitely the best game we've had so far. It was very close. I think there wasn't really any mistakes being made for quite a while there. And that's, of course, what really matters, is playing the best that you can. And seeing, you know, who holds out the longest until eventually somebody cracks, somebody loses a squad, and then you can capitalize on that.
Alrighty, so we're going to take a quick break.
With the players food and stuff. I'll have some more pizza.
We'll
and
back.
Some more root beer, which is just awful. Root beer. I knew it was going to be bad, but Kyle was so it's adamant mouthwash. That I try it, because it's like some kind of Canadian or North American thing that they live as root beer, but I wasn't a fan of it, to be honest.
It's just mouthwash, isn't it?
Yeah, it tastes like, it's like toothpaste combined with mouthwash.
If you guys want to type any questions, I'll probably be reading chat, if there's any, like, major questions, we'll address it when we get back, very, very shortly, but, I thought that was something else. But we'll be back in not too long. Thank you guys for joining. 800 viewers at the moment.
Yeah,
it's going
great.
Well, and join us for Game 5. It is going to be the last game of the Warpaint Championship. I'm really sad about that, but, anyway... Not too long to go. See you in a minute. All right, hello, we are back, and we're about to go into Game 5 of the Warpaint Championship Series, and awesome that we're having Game 5. I think it's really cool that we've actually had five games to play through today. Yeah, both players are just getting ready at the moment. They're doing the vetoes, and we do have a little interesting discussion about vetoes, don't we? Because the maps that are left, I think, Crossroads, Crossing in the Woods, and Famenville.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Are they the only three that remain?
I can't remember if Samoski Winter is in or not, but either way, the three that are left, as DevM was saying, are actually really good maps for Axis, for Vermont in particular. Because Crossroads, Crossing in the Woods, and Famenville, like, they're all so open, and that means they're very strong for the sniper, which is such a strong part of Wehrmacht, and especially of DevM's playstyle in particular. Whereas the maps we've had so far, Angoville we've had, and of course Kolodny, they're both maps that are very good for allies because of how close quarters combat they are, how many garrisons you have as well. So I actually think game number 5 is going to be a very close game. And given the map, it could actually be very dominant for the sniper in particular.
I mean, those are maps that DevM considers to be austere favored as well. You know, he says that those maps are heavily favored to austere.
Yeah.
That's his comfort zone. So actually, his Jezelin will most likely, we think, pick allies. He probably plays Soviets because that's what he's won. That's what he's won games with. The two games he's won today have been the Soviets. No reason for him to necessarily change.
I was also talking to Jezelin as well after that game. I actually asked him about his build as opposed to con spam. Apparently, in the semi-finals, which is when Jezelin initially lost to DevM, he actually tried the con spam and he didn't have much success with it against DevM sniper play. So this build is a specific reaction to DevM's playstyle. You can guess the M3 scout car out as a very strong anti-sniper, which has worked both times now. We've seen the M3 take the sniper out 1-for-1, 2-for-2, so good success with it. And it's impressive that he's able to keep it alive, because I find most players that try and go M3, the moment that the scout car shows up, the 2-2-2, it pretty much just gets taken out and doesn't really do much. But Jezelin was able to keep the M3 alive and really wait for the right moment to fully commit and get the wipe on that sniper. It was such a deadly combination, the negative cover combined with the veteran C2. Just, I've never seen a sniper die so fast to a scout car before.
No, that was really unfortunate as well. Like, but it was weirdly predictable. I was like, why is it there? Like, what was he? Was he trying to just like get around to take shots through the mid? But you could see, that scout car was coming across. He had like an MG there that was within range. So I think he knew as well that he made a silly mistake. I think he said like he made silly mistakes there, and he's feeling fairly confident.
We also were talking about the Stugi timing.
Yeah,
he got the Stugi before he knew the T-34 showed up, so he was a bit disappointed, because then he spent his manpower. So when he did see the T-34, he couldn't actually go for the pack. So we have Crossing in the Woods, and DevM as the Axis, the Wehrmacht. So this could be a very close game.
No, it's
did they restart?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe, you know what, they probably didn't do fixed spawns.
No, I think they messed up the positions, it looked like there. It looks like the map choice is Crossing in the Woods. Jezelin's going to be playing Soviets, Devon's going to be playing Austere. Kind of as expected. It looks like, as we say, they probably just messed something up. They've had to just restart the game quickly. So, we'll wait for that to come back on again. Unless one of them crashed or something.
Yeah.
Well, bug splats on
exactly
the wheel of RNG.
On the RNG wheel.
Was that on there? Did you have bug splat on
bug
there?
Bug splat. Was it? Oh, no, it wasn't, actually.
It wasn't on there. Didn't have bug splat.
Yeah, because RNG, like, bug splat isn't really RNG, is it? It's, you know, it's a bug. But it was more supposed to be the RNG wheel. But, but no, I'm sure it was just they forgot about the fixed locations.
Yeah.
But I think, I mean, this map, it's again, it's going to come down entirely to the M3, and as the first two games did as well, is how much damage can the M3 do? And more so, can Jezelin manage to find a window of opportunity where he can actually use the M3, go in for the kill, try and dive the sniper and actually take it out? Or will we see DevM keep the sniper alive, basically have the grenadiers nearby, make sure the retreat paths aren't too bad?
Sorry, the game is here. I'm just
good guy, Stormless.
It's just when it comes up with this little thumb to say that it's modded, I always get suspicious.
There's no mod, though. What?
I know. It's just I don't know. It seems weird to me.
Yeah.
We'll jump into it.
Because it says mod, but then it also says no mod is being played. Whatever.
There we go.
So looking at the commanders, we actually have the same commanders we've seen in this matchup many a times.
Chocolate wants us to spin the wheels.
Spin the wheel?
The wheel, I actually feel bad spinning the wheel, because it's pretty much always happened, you know?
Yeah.
Go on, spin it once, and we'll just do a quick one.
But who's this for, though?
Go on, huh?
Who's this for?
For both players.
For both of them?
Yeah, that's it. They've had their one each turn. You haven't got the ticker thing at the top.
Oh, of course.
That's right. There you go.
Oh, we're started the game, but we can wait. Just
it's alright, there's loads of wait time.
We have tank one shot squad.
Tank one shot.
So we're going to have a T-34 or a T-70 probably just blow up a squad of grenadiers. Or maybe the reverse, maybe it'll be a tiger one shotting a squad of penals.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay when you get units like that.
Yeah.
It's when the T-70 does it that you're like, really? You know? The whole squad.
Yeah.
Mind you, when the T-70 did it, it'd already taken a couple of shots,
yeah.
So they were low health, do you know what I mean? It was like, if they were going to all die, like, that would have been a situation that was a little acceptable, but... here we go, so yeah, Crossing the Woods. I have to say, I love casting games on Crossing the Woods. I really, really do love this map, and it's mainly due just to the design of it. I'm a massive fan of maps where you have this kind of symmetrical view. And I always really like about this is that depending on which way you go, you know, one, you're already kind of forced to go left and right for munitions and fuel, but the ones that are on your side of the river are kind of easier for you to take. But if you want to go over to your opponents, or even go for something like a central strategy, double munitions, you have to cross like the negative cover areas. And I really like that there's a way that you can perhaps take fuel on the right and benefit from like these choke points, but you do have the negative cover there to dissuade you from it. Whereas on like the other side, you have a nice little defense, you know, you can easier stop things from moving across. I think that's really important. For instance, if like USF was a faction, it's nice to stop the riflemen because they have to travel over that to get to you, and you have like, you feel like you maybe get a little more health off of them and you can get a few extra models down. But this is a regarded as an austere map.
Yep.
This is a great map for snipers. There's plenty of medium cover positions. There's plenty of angles for the sniper to snipe like across the river as well, you know, to these other little areas, and it's possible for snipers to get really, really good kill counts here.
It's just a very open map, so the sniper never really has to worry about shot blockers and not being able to find its targets. There is a pretty big opportunity for flanking though through the middle of the map, so the sniper, it does have to always make sure that it's being escorted by its bodyguards, the grenadiers with their Panzerfaust, so the M3 can't exactly go in for the kill. It's a great map for scout cars in general, so even double M3, for example, would actually be not a ridiculous idea. It could work pretty well, especially if you then end up having guards inside of them for the mobile anti-222.
Alright, hello everybody, and welcome to Game 5 of the Warpaint Championship Series. DevM versus Jezelin, or Insane DevM, as we see on the screen. But it hasn't quite been insane enough to close the 3-0 that he predicted yesterday. We are in a 2-2 situation at the moment. Jezelin has had faction selection for Game 3, but I believe DevM is pretty happy that the remaining maps to play on, such as Crossing in the Woods, he regards as being very, very good for him to play austere. So we're going to see how he does with that at the moment. But the stakes are very high. This is the last game of the tournament, and the players have everything to play for.
I wonder, actually, if Jizzlin will go for his own sniper. This is a great map for, of course, the Soviet sniper as well. So that wouldn't be a bad idea. The Grenadiers with the four-man squads, they can be a little bit vulnerable to the sniper taking away a quarter of their squad in every shot. It is a bit harder to keep alive, though, because especially when you have the 2-2-2 that can chase them down. When you have penals, they don't have any Fausts. So the sniper can be nice for the Soviets, but you generally would want to go for a couple of squads of guards first, just so you have actually some very powerful anti-scout cast, so the sniper has a bit more safety.
Do you think Devon's going to go for the classic house?
Well, he's trying to, I think. Yeah, he's trying to, but the penals won't let him. Actually, he's setting up the MG. This is pretty risky here. There's enemy grenadiers up close. He actually gets the shot off as well with the suppression. Wow, this is a great start for DevM now. He may secure that house.
This is DevM's signature thing on this map, really, is to get this building which covers this strategic point and just absolutely ignore the VP situation, ignore the resources, just deny everything from the allies and build up a powerhouse of Axis. And that could not have gone better for DevM there.
I think Jizzlin could have actually flanked the MG, but he kept the penal stationary for a few seconds there, and it allowed the MG to actually fire that off, get the suppression connecting. So I feel like that was a big mistake there from Jizzlin. But he is going for his M3, so he can flush that house out once he gets his flamer. But he doesn't have much munitions income, so it may take him a while to actually get the flamers out.
Go. Good pressure applied to the penal battalions at the moment. The scout car looks like it's trying to clear the grenadiers. Of course, the MG maybe has moved on now, trying to suppress penal battalions on the left side. Ooh, nearly loses a pretty important house there.
Okay, M3 is going after the MG. The crew's a little bit exposed here, so the MG has to reface.
I think he's going to go for this house again. I think it was the sensible choice. That protected is going to be very, very difficult for Jizzlin to play against, and because he's committed to tier one now, he doesn't have the mortar. He may have to go up to 2 CP and use guard mortar if he's going to get a mortar out. But it's going to cost him 400 manpower to do that. Because of that stop build, I think that was something maybe that Devon had predicted as well. And it's going to be tier one, and I can get away with this rush.
Flank with the Pioneers, Engineer's going to have to retreat through the MG42. Should survive this one, but the MG not actually firing. Is he set facing somewhere? And he's actually building a telemine, so he wants to have something against that scout car. Maybe the scout car will see the mine though, there's a lot of sight range. Hard to say if he actually saw that or not. I think we actually missed that one. Yeah, couldn't quite get the sight off in time, but Jizzlin, he has his guard motor locked in, so he will have the heavy mortar as an option. I believe the penals are actually upgrading themselves to the flamer inside of that M3, so DevM's going to have to back that MG away, otherwise he may lose it. But it's been a really great opener so far. The fuel has been connected the entire time here for DevM, so he shouldn't be too far off getting his 2-2-2.
Yeah, there we go. Flamer just pops as the scout car goes in. Faust is deployed. It's going to allow the MG hopefully to get away, and the penal battalion will try and get some shots off. The sniper's there to defend with the grenadiers too. Are the grenadiers going to try and bait the scout car eventually through the center area? Not going to happen at the moment, of course, but I really like that. I really like the early time, I have to say, because the last couple of games that Jizzlin has won, some of them have just been entirely due to the scout car. So, he's trying to lock that down straight away, and it's great protection for the sniper too.
Especially given how likely it was for the M3 to chase down the MG. Grenadiers are looking for the Faust on the M3 there, but I think they're just going for the wipe instead on the penal, but they'll be fine. So the right side fuel has been capped for Jizzlin, but again, it may get cut off here by the Grenadier squad. He couldn't actually get the repair off on the M3, but now the guards have shown up. They wouldn't have the DPs just yet, but they're still very powerful.
Yeah, this, I think, may end up... I don't want to say it's a mistake, because it isn't. But DevM's going to have the snipers really, really honing down on those guard squads. It's going to be, with the little amount that Jizzlin has on the field,
You have to spend a lot of time reinforcing these.
Another telemine's being planted there, The M3 has to be very careful with where it paths, and maybe Jezelin should go for the sweeper rather than the flamer on his engineers. I guess the heavy mortar out, so that's going to be good against the MGs, especially if he tries to go for those houses. But of course, the sniper's going to be very mobile, able to poke away at the infantry and even the mortar itself. Oh, he actually gets a sweeper, nice. So he will clear out this telemine.
Yeah, that's a good play from Jezelin, though.
Oh, the other teller, though, gonna blow up the M3. And the penalties as well, three models go down.
Nope. The enemy is attempting to steal our sector.
People raining from the sky after that telemine there.
Really good start here for DevM. Let's see his teching. Maybe he'll actually skip the 222, because now he killed the M3, so he doesn't really need a 222. He could probably just go straight for a Panzer IV. Or maybe he'll just go for a 222, but he hasn't really had that much command points. This game hasn't been that fast-paced. It's almost 7 minutes and only 3 CPs, so I don't think Stugi is going to be an option. It'll take far too long, especially compared to how much fuel he actually has. Double Muni's points as well, that's really important for the Axis. If he can get LMGs on all of these Grenadiers, keep spamming more S-mines to really limit map mobility, especially if you put S-mines in that middle VP, it really limits mobility through the map and hard to actually take that VP, so putting mines there is so important. There's actually a lot of choke points in this map where S-mines can be very punishing.
Yeah, I mean, it's dream situation for Gabe 5 here with DevM, and the heavy mortar is doing reasonable work, but I mean, DevM's just too quick with this repositioning. He really is moving loads. You can see his movements on the point. He's just constantly paying attention to this. Jezelin's trying to focus on getting the VP decap. I think he realizes the significance of losing a triple cap early on. This is going to make things very difficult for him. It's going to create a lot of ease for DevM to close the game down quicker. So he needs to be very, very careful of this. And traditionally, it's the allies that want to take the VPs away from the Axis. You do not want to give them the long game potential. But again, like, good positioning from DevM here. He's going to come around the left side. Just picking off units. Picking them off with no real care in the world. Without that scout car, the sniper's in pretty safe control at this point. We
are losing double guards here for Jezelin. So we'll have the infantry advantage. Two penals, two guards, a very strong mix. DevM going for a double sniper, which I think is actually fantastic. I think it's a really smart choice. Perhaps he is vulnerable, because again, he has no anti-tank. He has killed the M3, and Jezelin, he couldn't possibly have a T-70 this early, but DevM needs to get a pack out as soon as he gets that second sniper, because otherwise, he could just get steamrolled by a T-70. Maybe he will go to Puma, given that he will have 5 command points at the time, and a Puma's going to give him a lot more anti-T-70 than what a pack will. And of course, that's not as good as late game, but when you have two snipers, he should be able to just completely shut down the penals and the guards. It won't even matter.
Making use of that heavy mortar. Jezelin managed to kind of get a lot of the map back then, which I was surprised. I didn't think he'd be able to do that, but he has. He's managed to kind of get the field a little bit back under his control. The real question is, how is he going to deal with these snipers? Is he going to be relying, really, on this heavy mortar to kind of pick them off? That's certainly how it seems. And in fact, the scatter here may help him out. He's going to go for another scout car.
Wow.
Which I guess is the best thing he has at his disposal at this point to deal with this situation. If he can get a good scout car rolling, like
now he's so vulnerable, isn't he?
Well, yeah, I mean, taking out, for instance, both those snipers would be an incredible turn of events here. It's equally risky in the sense that, at the moment, they're, like, unprotected. Fortunately, there's 3 Grenadiers, so Fausts are, should be easy, but Devim isn't really using them how we've seen him use them in previous games. They're not as protected as they have been elsewhere.
That sniper with half health is so vulnerable as well. The mortar can take him out very easily if it hits near him, so I definitely hope the sniper actually gets healed up, and DevM now building a pack, so Jezelin not really making use of the opportunity, but he still has a little bit of a window here now. The M3 is going forward, with the penals. The snipers are pretty far back towards their base, though, so I think he should be fine, especially with the MG setting up. Actually, we're going to use the incendiary on this on the conscript, rather than the combat engineers. It goes down, and now there's going to be the M3 going in. He may get one of them. Where is the pack? Just arriving now, but the Grenz are showing up here. There goes one sniper. The double Faust will come through. Can he wipe the sniper in time, though? Out of munitions is Devem. There goes the M3. The sniper's juking around the HQ. Penal's looking for the wipe here. How good is the juking, Devem? It's pretty good so far, but maybe it won't be enough. Oh my god, this is so close!
The tension. Jezzen's gonna have to consider.
Oh, excellent! Look at that! He gets the satchel off on the bunker. Nice! He took my advice, but let's see if the penals go down. Doesn't have the incendiary as an option.
Devem has the cheek to take a shot on the retreat as well.
Fantastic play there from Jezzelin. He gets one sniper, and he gets the med bunker, and that was the vetted sniper too, so that was a great play. And again, Devem, he made the same mistake.
The enemy is taking our territory.
Oh, look at his squads. Yeah. He lost the penals. I didn't see that on retreat.
Yeah, well, the penals went down to the MG on the retreat.
Right,
so
I didn't see that.
Jezzelin, like, Devem, whilst dealing with all of that, repositioned an MG on the retreat path, knowing that squad was going to come through. There we have it. Wow. Devem.
What an end.
The coffee really kicked in that game. And Devem takes takes the first place position.
I still think that may have been a little bit early to throw in the towel, though. Mm. Given that, like, he had enough resources for a T-70, he wasn't completely out of it. Like, yeah, he was in a rough spot because he lost a squad of penals. But he had the heavy mortar. He could have got some wipes for that if he was lucky. Yeah. He could have, used the guards in conjunction with the T-70. I feel like he maybe just got a bit too emotional. I think he definitely should have stayed in. Mm. There's a lot of money on the line here, and when you're Soviets, you always have the potential to get some wipes with the T-70 and with the mortar, and perhaps bring it around for you.
Well, you know, the problem is, like, Axis is so strong at the moment that, it's really difficult to stay in a game when you start losing units as allies. Like,
yeah.
There's no point. Axis is just too OP. As Devem knows.
Yeah. Well, that's it. That's the Warpaint Championship wrapped up. It's 3-2 in favor of Devem. He is our winner. The Portuguese player.
We'll get him in, I think, for a little congratulations thing. Maybe just see, like, how they're feeling. But the first four games were really, really good. I have to say, like, I really enjoyed that. The last one was a little bit of Devem just kind of like strolling in. And do you know what? Losing that house at the beginning, I think that was such a predictable little strategy, really, from Devem. It's something he's always done. It was so cool. I think it was OCF that he started doing that. And it was just so, it was so good. And I think once he gets into that position, if you haven't gone tier 2 and you don't have the access to the mortar, he was so trapped. And the rush with the penal battalion, like the flamer penals and the scout car, was great, and it was the right thing to do. But unfortunately, like, it's so much of a good early game that it wasn't enough. I think we have the guys. Yep, send them in.
Congratulations, Devem.
Congratulations. We have the old microphone up.
Well, where do we start, Stormless?
Well, let's start by talking about the last game. So obviously, we'll have a little bit of discussion about, like, everything in general. That last game, winning with Austere on that map, you said it was kind of an Austere map. We think we were just discussing that house on the northern side of Crossing in the Woods. That's like a signature thing for you. How did you feel when you see him get into that house? You know, was this a moment of oops?
Well, I'm on the cable. Sorry.
No worries.
In our games that we played for the tournament, to some Camstone games, he did the same and. Yep. I couldn't do anything because it's just impossible.
Yeah, yeah. So I was like, because we were discussing as well, like the builds, the difference in builds for austere and Soviet. So when you go penals, Devem had three squads on the field. He's got the MG, the Grenadiers, the Pioneers, and you end up, by the time the penal battalion comes on the field, do you feel that's like the a weakness of not going for the conscripts, is that you don't have the reaction response to that strategy?
Yes, I know, but if you go conscripts on that map, he will spam two snipers, and I don't have any chance.
Yeah. So did you think, like, the... Did you not think to veto that map? That's what I was trying to say.
No, because if I play over Commando, for example, the other maps were a shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was my only choice.
Yeah,
on that map.
Crossroads would be just as bad for Austria, surely.
It depends.
Know. Yeah.
We played a lot of games on that map, and he won me all day.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
So did you kind of have a feeling of you knew how it was going to go?
Yeah.
You're so honest, you know? You're so honest.
Yeah, but I played very well these series.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it was amazing four games. Yeah. Like the first ones were brilliant and great. How was it for you, like, the other games as well?
The first one?
Yeah.
The first two games, I mean, the first game, besides, like, the first... minutes where I did those mistakes of letting him up, so map control shouldn't, it went well. Second game and fourth were kinda the same, because I did a lot of early mistakes with Austere, which get punished a lot, and he just kinda controlled it from there. And in the third game, which was a US game for me, I think that it's my best faction, so it went very well, I guess. He did get my cutoff early, but I had multiple units behind his front line, so I just cut him off too. And then just from there, it was like snowballing the game.
Do you have any, like, effect for both of you? Because you played exceptionally well with the Soviet factions today. You played exceptionally well with Austria. Do you have any, like, advice to give people who are maybe struggling with those factions or, like, just want to know more about...
You mean Austria?
Yeah, you for Austria, yeah.
I mean, Austria is kind of in a delicate position right now. If you're talking about auto-match, I would say probably try to veto the maps that are like close-ranged ones and just try to play around with the sniper mostly. I mean, sniper, it's kind of a hard unit to use, but if you get to use it well, Austria really gets going.
Yep, yep. And of course you for Soviets, because the Soviet games you played, the builds were really strong.
So. Yeah, they were good games. In the first one, I spam Wars, the typical Soviet game of this patch. And in the second one, I try something different with Partisan, and it worked very well.
Yeah.
Bad luck with the third game of Soviets, but he played better than me.
Yeah.
So he deserved the win.
How come you decided to concede that early? Because I think you still had a decent chance. You had enough fuel for the T-70... You had a bit of manpower. You actually took out his med bunker as well. I feel like it was definitely... You were on the back foot. It would have been a struggle. But how come you were so sure that you didn't have a chance?
No, I was unable because I lost so many squads. Some wars. I didn't have hell on my base.
Oh, you didn't have medics.
And
okay.
He was probably waiting for an Stugi.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. So it was game over.
Say that again, sorry, Devin.
I hadn't picked commander yet, but that would have probably been a Steggy. Even if he went for the T-70, I probably would have a Puma out to counter it.
Yeah. Yeah, it was definitely... it's hard to play after that because you have the sniper alive, and I mean, the guards have to be stationary to be effective, so the sniper's pretty powerful against them. But the heavy mortar can always change games. You always have the potential to get a lucky wipe with that or the T-70. So it's you do have to have a pretty good start on Crossing in the Woods, I think. But congratulations to DevM for winning the $2,000. I believe it's US dollars, isn't it?
It is, yeah. So 2,000, 1,000, I think, is first and second place for that one.
Yeah.
Both winners, of course, still. I guess that kind of wraps up the tournament. I hope you guys enjoyed being in Vancouver as well. You have to say, like, thank you to Relic for hosting the event and just doing all these awesome things to bring you guys along. We've enjoyed it. Have you guys enjoyed
great.
It?
Yep. Yeah.
Yep, there's a bit more enthusiasm just for the just for Twitch. Come on, like, yeah. unless we have anything else.
Well, I'm going to be posting all of these videos on my Twitch. Oh, sorry, my YouTube. So if you missed some of the earlier games or you want to rewatch them for whatever reason, then make sure you have youtube.com/generalsgentlemen subscribed, and you will see those games there, as well as the interview from yesterday that we did. That'll also be posted on the channel. So that's basically all I have to say, Stormless.
Yeah.
If that's it, then thank you for watching. Thank you for supporting Company of Heroes, watching our streams. It's always nice to have you in there. And we'll see you next time, tournament, next stream, next cast that we do.
Stay tuned for Dawn of War 3 NDA leaks.
Oh, yes, yes. We're definitely keen to get our hands on DAO 3. Or at least something that we can present.
Fantastic. All right, well, thank you, everyone, for watching. We hope you enjoyed Warpaint Championship. Thanks for all the support. Thanks for hitting the milestones, which, of course, have ended up with us all here together. It's been absolutely fantastic. And that's pretty much it. Till next tournament.
See ya.